the Humpbacks at play off the Gold Coast. Everybody's having a good time here this weekend. Gee, don't you wish you could do that? Looks like a lot of fun. Anyway, we have a lot more action coming up for you. Of course, the Champ Car race, the Lexmark Indy 300, and the final race of the Gillette V8 Supercar Challenge. In the meantime, a man who has done a lot for Australian motorsport in the last couple of years. He's running three drivers here this weekend in the Champ Car race. Two of them are Australian, and he, of course, has a franchise now in V8 Supercars, and he's expanding all the time. Craig Gore.
If you were to give yourself a mark out of 10 thus far, what would it be?
9. Made 2 podiums in your first year. We're the best looking team in pit lane, bar none. I think our marketing is 10 out of 10. And I think when you look at everywhere we've gone around the world, everywhere, we've sold out of merchandise. We can't sell enough hats, can't sell enough shirts, can't sell enough underpants, can't sell enough shoes, can't sell enough socks. I mean, we are selling out of it. People are intrigued with Australia. They're intrigued in what we do as a nation, not just as a race team, but you know, who we are, our culture, our people, our history. They want to be part of it. And you know, the world, we're a long way from anybody.
So what do you want from this weekend?
A 1, 2, 3, how good would that be? A podium. And I really think we're ready for it. More importantly, I'd like to think that Australia and our fans can get behind the concept and embrace it. This is the Gold Coast's only international team. It's our only international motorsport team that's owned by Australians at this stage. And we've been the only team in 38 years to get on a podium with an Australian-owned international team. I'd like to think that it becomes more embraced, because I don't think it has been leaded, and I think people have treated it as, you know, a bit of a farce, to be honest.
A, why? B, what will change that?
A, why? Me? I think that
why? Because you're a colourful character?
I don't know if I'm colourful, Lee. I think that, you know, I just say it as it is, you know, and I don't like to mince words. You know, we can go on with a lot of, you know, stories and create some falsities. I just say it as it is. I don't think people like that, you know. I think sometimes that has a negative impact on what I'm doing and how I'm going about doing it. And I think that, you know, when I first joined the V8 series, a lot of people said, oh, this guy, who is he, you know. Now I'm here to stay. It's like, geez, what do we do? Keep him away, right? Let's bury this guy. And I think that Champ Car, or our Team Australia outfit, you know, they haven't had a chance to see it. I think when they get to see it, they'll be blown away by it.
So part B of that question, what will change the way people view your team?
This weekend, I think people will see that we are the best outfit in Champ Car, in pit lane. There's no question about it. I've been around the world with this series, and we are, bar none, the best.
To switch gears, we'll talk V8 supercars for a moment. At Bathurst, it was great to see the WPS car in the top 10, and it was running at the front with Bernard behind the wheel early on. But there was a driver error, and that affected the whole day.
I think that moment for us, David going into the sand, and you know, we lost concentration, and we left him out there, double stint. The only guy out there that was doing a double stint. He worked pretty hard. Even though it's probably the most gut-wrenching feeling, because they go, oh, geez, Bezzy's in the sand again, you know. I actually think it was the thing that gelled us as a team. I think moving forward, we can only improve and become stronger. And I think this weekend, I'd be very surprised if we weren't in the top 10.
What silly season news have you got?
We'll get into Le Mans this year, and I think that'll be a pretty exciting thing, again, for Team Australia.
In what car?
The Porsche.
With which drivers?
Well, there's a lot to choose from, but I think the two Champ Car drivers and the two V8 drivers. I think they're two of the most amazing series in the world. And to promote both of those series using other forms of motorsport, it can only be good for me and good for the sports, and you know, probably have people see me in a different light than actually not a bad light.
They went close to a top 10 finish in that race, incidentally. Craig Baird finished 12th, but David Bernard once again locked in battle with the Castrol Perkins mob, Stephen Richards in this case, so they renewed hostilities there. It's a long weekend, isn't it? Anything can go wrong, and probably will at some stage. Well, Mark Howard had similar thoughts when he was elected to be a judge for the Miss Indy Bikini or Swimwear contest. So let's see how he fared.
The unbelievable chance to judge the Miss Indy Bikini Contest. Oh my gosh. You wouldn't think life could get any better.
I would absolutely love to be an IndyCar judge.
How much would you pay to be a judge?
Mate, you couldn't put a figure on it.
We've got about 3,500 people behind us just waiting to start the judging.
The girls were feeling the pressure, and so was I. A huge crowd and the dreams of so many young ladies depending on each and every judge, no matter how inexperienced.
Oh my gosh, to be Miss Bartercard, Miss Indy would be amazing.
Oh, it would mean the world to me.
You're judging on figure, personality and confidence. 40 girls is a hell of a commitment, all right?
I was prepared to commit to the cause. Roscoe, the organiser, providing me with a very special helping hand.
So we're going to ask him to take along with him Bartercard, Miss Indy, Miss Jane Lee O'Neill to coach him, ladies and gentlemen.
Jane, as a novice, what should we be looking for?
We're looking for a girl who's got a finely tuned body, a sporty, and can hold herself well.
It looks like all the girls have got fairly finely tuned bodies, Jane.
Yeah, to get to this stage, you've got to be pretty hot. Make y'all wanna jam, fellas in the
place, just clap your hands. I tell you, it is not an easy gig, this one. Every bloke in the crowd wants your job. There's so many girls, there's so many bikinis, and you can only give so many perfect tens.
Judging etiquette ain't easy. I don't think you're meant to clap. Whilst rubbing your hands together seems a little tacky. But then with so many beautiful girls dancing and prancing past you, how on earth are you meant to sort out the scores?
What advice can you give me?
That's right, we don't know.
I don't know, man. Just follow your heart.
Easy for a racing car driver. Vassal and Oriel Servia weren't even out of first gear. Calmly eating pizza, if you don't mind. Jimmy, you're a champ car driver. You're a Miss Indy judge, and all this you're eating pizza while you're doing it, Jimmy. Is this the best job in the world?
Yeah, I got a cold beer down here I can crack open if I want to, but I don't want to set a bad example.
Nerves of steel, the superstars, scoring away, concentrating on the job at hand, whilst I was at the point of simply staring. 40 girls, all perfect in their own way, tens all round. What about a judgment on the judges?
Yeah, did you see me judging down there, Courtney?
I did.
How do you think I went?
Oh, you did good. You were very happy. You had a nice face. So I could
happy,
smile.
Happy, Courtney? How could I not be happy?
Yeah, I know, but some judges are just a bit scary. You weren't scary.
Do you think I'll get the job again next year?
Absolutely.
I think we've found our winner.
Not surprisingly, I was overruled. Not that you could disagree with the end result. Miss Indy 2005, Jana Peterson from Townsville.
Congratulations to Jana. We'll take a break and have more racing pretty soon.
Throw your diamonds in the sky if you feel the vibe. The rock is still alive every time I rhyme. Forever, ever, ever, ever.
We better be careful. Someone's stolen Daryl Beattie's boat. Just one of the many pleasure craft that is cavorting off the coast here as we get ready to go racing once again. The champ cars are lining up and they'll be out on the track pretty soon. There'll be a driver's parade. Neil Crompton will join me for that. In the meantime, one of the great battles we've seen this year is, of course, Paul Tracy versus Sebastian Bourdais. Two entirely different personalities. We've heard from the laid-back Bourdais. What about Paul? He's been outspoken this weekend.
The topic du jour is your conflict with Sebastian. Where is all that at the moment?
Well, I think we saw where it's at inside. Obviously, it's it's a subject of debate. You know, he doesn't think in any way that he's in the wrong and wants to drop the subject, and obviously it's from my standpoint, if the shoe was on the other foot and it was him being crashed and it was me that was behind him, it would be a huge issue. So
is there an issue of respect there, Paul? I mean, should he respect you more?
I mean, that's hard to say. That's really a question for him. Obviously, you know, I feel that he's a great driver. You don't win the amount that he's won without being a great driver. But I think it's just, you know, when it comes down to it, we're very much opposites outside of the race car, and very much the exact same inside the race car. We don't give anybody anything, and when we're both fighting, we're fighting for the same piece of road usually, and neither of us is willing to give up that piece of road, so usually ends up in us having each other off or having a crash. So, you know, that's a situation that it will probably continue to keep happening because we both have the same mentality.
You mentioned NASCAR a couple of answers ago. Is that still anywhere on your landscape?
It is. Obviously, I'm looking at right now doing a selected amount of events for next year. Try to put the right program together. Obviously, I want to keep my rookie status in that, so I've got 7 events that I would like to try to do. Anything over 7 and you lose your rookie status. So really that's a situation where long term it's something that I would like to do, but I'm really unsure of whether I want it.
What's this event mean to you, mate? I mean, we have absolutely loved having you every year down here, but what does it mean to you?
Well, it's just a huge event. It's one of the biggest events of the year for Champ Car, and obviously the whole country is behind it. The support of the fans is fantastic, and it's really what Champ Car's tried to do in the States. Obviously, you know, with the success that this race has had here, they bring a lot of the people from America to watch this event and say, this is how you need to do an event, and this is the way it should be done. And we've done that in the United States with events based off of what the Australians do here.
You have a lot of equity in the upswing, the upturn of this championship and the upturn in momentum. Do you feel that way, and do you feel satisfied, and do you feel like you've got a stake in its new success?
Well, I think I've contributed to the success of it. Obviously, when you lose a lot of the good drivers like we did, some guys went to the IRL, guys like myself and Bruno and Jimmy stayed here in kart, and Cristiano came back to kart. So we've got a good core base of great drivers, and that obviously is something that is vital to make the series keep its popularity. So I feel like I've been a part of that.
Let me paint a scenario for you. It's a beautiful sunny day on Sunday. It's in the afternoon, it's late in your race. In fact, it's the last lap. Sebastian Bourdais leading, you're running second. You've just crossed the line, you got the white flag, one to go.
I don't know, depends how close I am. I know we owe, paybacks can be a bitch, I guess.
Those words may come back to haunt Paul Tracy before the day is over. He's pretty handily placed in this event, and so, of course, is Sebastian Bourdais, as usual. And so, too, is Cristiano DiMatta. He was here as a champion just a few years back. Then he went to Formula One, didn't quite work out, and everyone kind of felt a little sorry for him when he was struggling to get a drive in the subsequent months. He did get a drive back in Champ Car, not in an extremely competitive team, but it all seems to be finally coming together. So we're looking forward confidently to 2006 with Cristiano DiMatta.
You're back in the Champ Car Series, and we've not seen you in that here for the last few years. Are you enjoying your time back in the series?
Yeah, very much. Obviously, you can always be better when you get better results. We had a very inconsistent season so far, so definitely could have been a much better return if we were performing as we thought we were going to be at the beginning of the season. But it's the way it goes. Sometimes we have hard seasons that are more difficult than the others. Obviously, we have to try to avoid them as much as we can, and we have been putting a lot of work now towards the end of the year, so I expect these last two races, Surfers and also the last race in Mexico City, to be a little bit better than we've been these last few races.
What's been the problem in terms of the consistency? Is it to be able to get the correct engineering package on the car? Is it just the chemistry between yourself and the engineer? Or what's been the difficult aspect?
We are a little bit short on people in our engineering group, so the guys are extremely busy trying to figure everything out. We have more information than we have people to sort out the information and put everything together. So that kind of slows us down a little bit, make us during a race weekend and even throughout the year to develop a little bit slower than some of the other guys. But we're looking for that for next year, and we're actually going to, we have a good plan laid down that we're not going to be short on people for next year anymore. We have good guys we've been talking to as far as engineers, and we're going to bring some new engineers on. The team has real good plans for next year, so hopefully we'll see BKV Racing in a much better shape next year.
What about this racetrack? You've had success on it. You've had a pole position here. You've won a race here. You've typically enjoyed this track. Is it a track that you have good memory of?
Yes, very much. Since my first year here, I really enjoyed the track. Since the very first time I drove on it. It's a difficult track. It's a tough track to drive. It's a technical track. It's a kind of a unique street track because it's much longer than the other ones. I like the chicanes and I like the curbing. I like the fact that you can use different lines by attacking the curb, curbing different ways. It's a track I really enjoy. It's in my, not because I'm in Australia, but this is my favorite street race.
Was it frustrating for you to have achieved the magnificent goal of getting into Formula One? And in that first season there, I think I recall you beat Olivier in the points and you led the British Grand Prix, you did a lot of spectacular things, and the dream didn't come together for whatever reason. Was that a disappointment for you?
I have no hard feelings or not frustrating that I'm not racing there right now. I'm 100% happy here. Not 100% happy here because I'm not getting the results I wanted to get, but I'm very happy here. Obviously, I'm working hard, and I think the performance thing that we're missing this year, I think we're going to get it right very soon.
I imagine that you've been welcomed back with a great deal of enthusiasm and probably almost like coming home to your family in some respects, because you did Indy Lights with great success and then Champ Car ultimately became the champion, 7 wins in 2002 and so on.
Actually, during the whole season, like welcoming back and glad to have you here again, and you know, it was all my pleasure, to be honest. But it was very nice to see that, you know, places you really have friends, you really feel it, the atmosphere becomes different to you.
Congratulations on getting back to a top drive in this series, Cristiano. Great
Thank
to have you back here.
Thank you, my pleasure.
Good luck this weekend.
Thank you.
Thanks, man.
It is great to have Cristiano back in the championship, and he may not be conscious of it. He certainly wouldn't have done it deliberately, but the return of he to the championship and Justin Wilson from Formula One will help other drivers come back to a series that a couple of years ago was ailing. We'll be back very soon.
Found a rare quiet moment in the pit lane for a good opportunity to undress a Champ Car. So what is a Champ Car? Well, it's a purpose-built single-seater racing car made from a composite carbon fibre material. I've got Les and Craig here with me from Team Australia to help undress the car. Boys on cue, if you can just pluck a bit of gear off, we'll get into the juicy stuff. Starting at the front of the car, of course, these cars are dominated by wings and their aerodynamic performance. They do just on 300 kilometres an hour at this racetrack. At that speed, they're good for just under 2,000 kilograms of downforce. Can you believe that? Pulls them to the road, drags them to the road. This is the front wing assembly. Hey, if you knock one of these things off on the concrete this weekend, and it's been done once or twice here, about $40,000 Australian. Here's the little adjuster to make movements on this front flap. One turn equals a third of a degree, equals about 3 or 4 kilos of downforce variation. The thing about that, if you pull more downforce on, the natural enemy of downforce is drag, slows the cars down in a straight line. Of course, that makes an interesting combination for the driver and the engineer to work through to try and get the most performance out of the car. Look at the front suspension. Beautiful front dampers, springs, about $10,000 to $12,000 US worth of kit here. Down around the front, you've got the front anti-roll bars, 3 pedals tucked in here, accelerate on the right, brake pedal in the middle, clutch on the left, a couple of bulkheads built into the car for driver safety. You get a good idea here of the way in which this thing's made. See, it's carbon fibre. It's not metal, as you would expect to see in, for example, a V8 supercar. Down in here, where the driver sits, where all the business is done, steering wheel, full LED display, lots of buttons to play with in terms of communication, push to pass, radio, comms, even a drink. Drivers need to have a bludge. On the right-hand side, you've got the gear lever. It's a sequential gearbox, flat shifting, just pull back first, second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, and seventh. Some people gear them for six-speed round here. Little red lever on the left helps you engage reverse, anti-roll bar controls, brake bias control. Everything a driver needs to function is in there. Six-point harness, a custom-built seat. It's actually a very comfortable place to work. Rollover hoop. In here, between driver and the engine, is the fuel tank, 35 US gallons, about 132 litres in Australian terms. There's the fueling point, but on this side is actually the single point refuelling where both the fuel and the vent coupling go in as one. But this is the bit that I really like. Look at that. 750 horsepower sitting there ready to bubble away. Ford Cosworth, 2.65 litre, 90 degree, double overhead cam, 32 valve V8. Turbocharged, so it's got a small capacity, but when you ram the methanol and the air into there, it effectively gives you more capacity. It's a powerful little baby, this thing. Good round here for about 300 k's. Of course, on the bigger ovals, these things are good for almost 400 kilometres per hour. Transaxle means that the gearbox and the diff's all built into one unit, and this is a stressed member, like me most of the time, meaning in fact this is part of the structural rigidity of the car. You can't really see it too well, but the turbo's tucked in there. Massive heat around the back of the car. Here's the rear suspension, dampers, springs, adjustability there on the shocks. These little things here, see these? They alter the ride height of the car, which is critical on a bumpy street circuit like this. Rear wing assembly. 40-odd grand for the front, 15-odd for the rear. Adjustability here because you can change this gurney flap to change the way in which the car behaves. This one's the 1-inch or about 24, 25 mil. They come in 6, 12, 18 and 24. They obviously vary the performance of the car. More wing, more downforce, slower in a straight line. You've got to be careful at. Look, you could talk about this for hours on end. These are beautiful race cars. $500,000 for a rolling chassis. $1.7 million to lease the engine for a year. It's heaven on a stick. Thanks, Team Australia, for letting us play with it.
Now to our purpose-built commentator. Self-confessed, stressed member. And I'll leave it at that. Neil, bit of build-up of cloud in the south and the wind's coming from that direction. There was a forecast for a few showers today. What do you think?
I just looked over my shoulder as we were about to come back on air and I thought to myself, doesn't look that flash down towards the southwest, particularly building up out over the mountains at the moment. So there it is. When you see those build-ups here in the afternoon, there's every chance we might get a shower. It was on the forecast. So let's hope we get a clean race in. It is earlier this year for 2005. The Champ Cars run earlier because we've got a V8 supercar race to come later in the afternoon.
And just quickly running through some practice figures this morning, Justin Wilson came out on top. His time was 1 minute 33.7. Servia second fastest, Almendinger, Bourdais, DeMarta, Tracy, Dominguez, Vasser, Tagliani and Rodolfo Levin. No big surprises there, Neil. Was there any other news out of practice? Things seem to be going fairly smoothly. Those guys who were chasing set up, let's hope they've caught their targets.
I caught up with a couple of the drivers just before and just after the warm-up. Paul Tracy told me that accident that he had yesterday down at Turn 3 when he smacked the wall did a fair amount of damage. Broke the gearbox on the car, and that little item that we had just a moment ago, we showed the transaxle where the gearbox and differential are all part of one cast unit. Well, he hit the wall that hard. Not only did it damage the right rear suspension, but it broke that entire gearbox casing. That's a very, very expensive item. But the car's back in good shape. He's pretty happy with his car. In fact, Mario Dominguez, he's very unwell. I had a chat to him. He's a former race winner here. And he said, oh, mate, I feel dreadful. He got sick when he arrived in town about Wednesday and he hasn't recovered. He's gone downhill. He's got a lot of muscular aches and pains. So he's taking a few things and he's also got some ice packs on his lower back because he said everything just aches badly. He doesn't notice it when he's in the race car. When he gets out of the car, he's really paying for it. But I was impressed to see Justin Wilson performing so well this morning. I went to Montreal just two races back, missed the Vegas race, but he was very, very strong up there, the ex-Formula One driver from both Minardi and from Jaguar. He settled well into Roux Sport now as that team continues to grow, and I reckon those guys will be pretty strong here. And Cristiano DeMarta was strong in the warm-up this morning as well. So, look, I think there's a good probably five, maybe six drivers in this race that have certainly got cars that are well capable. Yesterday it was fantastic to see Oriol Servia do such a good job in qualifying, grabbing his very first pole position. The other thing that hasn't really made big headlines over the course of the weekend, he kind of made a quiet announcement about it. There's Oriol there. First Champ Car pole in 97 starts, Sebastian Bourdais. I was going to make a point about the fact that Paul Tracy has re-signed for Forsyth for 2006, so he'll remain in the series next year. And Lee spoke to him earlier about whether or not he would engage more the whole notion of NASCAR, and he'll do that perhaps in the future.
As Tracy waves to the crowd in typical get-up, some of the drivers in race suits, but there's no doubt about Paul, he's laid back with the sleeveless T-shirt. We will have a look at yesterday's highlights. There were plenty.
A picturesque backdrop, but a punishing street circuit. All the more reason to qualify well. And it was Cristiano D'Amato who was on an early flyer.
Good time from Cristiano D'Amato.
Nelson Philippe left his mark on the track, but for all the wrong reasons. Paul Tracy also had an excursion into the concrete. It appeared Mario Dominguez would snatch his first ever Champ Car pole.
Dominguez goes to the top of the times.
In the dying minutes of qualifying, Bourdais tried to put together a fast lap.
That hurts Sebastian when he could least afford it.
Instead, his teammate enjoyed the spoils.
Serbia to the top, 32-6.
It's the first pole position for Serbia, who is joined by Bourdais on the front row. Dominguez and D'Amato are next on the grid. Tracy fifth. Team Australia's Tagliani is ninth. Teammates Will Power and Marcus Marshall will start just outside the top 10. The battle for the championship was well and truly played out in race one of the V8 supercars.
Oh, three abreast into turn one. Skate's going deep, very deep, too deep.
Marcus Ambrose was the first big name to fall.
And Ambrose has got issues. Marcus Ambrose has problems. He's dropped two positions.
Todd Kelly also headed for the pits. His race over.
We said this was going to be dramatic.
Smooth work in the pits kept Murphy in the lead.
There they are. That's the margin, first to second.
A mistake by Scaife saw Lowndes pounce for second.
So he's outbraked himself on the run to turn one, and then gathers it back up when Craig whistles by.
But no one could catch Murphy.
To victory in his 100th start.
The race results have given championship leader Ingall valuable points. Steady driving from McConville, Jason Richards and Ellery saw them finish strongly. Bright, Rick Kelly and Tander also snuck into the top 10.
Well, as I said at the very top of the program, a lot still to play for in the V8 Supercar Championship. The championship is pretty much over in Champ Cars, as long as Sebastian Bourdais can make it to the green flag and start running the race. Even if he pulls out after that, he has enough in the bag. But they're out there and they're into it because, in a sense, the fact that it's already been decided now gives us a really good scope for a great race.
Yeah, there's always lots to play for in this championship. A win is a win and everybody's wheeling and dealing for next year, so they won't be mucking around regardless of the championship this year.
When we come back, we'll have the celebrations, the ceremonies before the big race today. Everybody's turned up. Here we go with the roulettes. It looks as though they're actually going between the buildings, Neil. It's extraordinary. I mean, I'm not sure what their regulations are here, but it's quite spooky and quite spectacular.
Pilatus PC9s are fantastic, aren't they? These guys do an amazing job. They wander all over the country at the large events and put on these magnificent precision displays. I was very lucky several years ago when we were racing in Canberra at the V8 Supercar race down there to have a run with these guys together with Garth Tander. One of the great experiences, sitting in the back of that aircraft while these very highly skilled pilots do their thing. It's just so freaky to sit in one and see another aircraft like 2 or 3 metres away as the drivers wrap up their driver's parade for Champ Car. It just doesn't look right when you see an aircraft off the wingtip.
I thought you flew like that all the time.
Try not to.
There's Tagliani getting right into the Aussie spirit there, with what looks like a Crocodile Dundee-style hat. And that is a... Peter Beattie really enjoys himself at these events. That is a formidable combination. Will Power, Marcus Marshall, Tagliani. They all qualified very close to one another. Not sure if Tags would be too happy with that, given that Marcus has only had a handful of races and Will none. But there was a general consensus, according to Tagliani, about the dissatisfaction those drivers had with their cars. and that meant they're all going in the right direction, getting their heads together and hopefully sorting them out for the race. They were just thinking they needed a little bit more to be competitive today.
Justin Wilson,
he's very Brit, tall,
just walking towards us. He is just 26 years of age. A lot of experience though in these cars. There's Alex Tagliani.
And now the presidents of the USA, the band I'm talking about, to play a little music for us.
Hey everybody, Australia, we are the presidents of the United States of America from Seattle, professional rock band. We have a new album out called Love Everybody. This song is the first single. It's called Some Postman. It's 6 a.m. and the sun is getting hot. He picks up the mail from the slot. He feels the rush of excitement as he holds it in his hand. Another love note no one got. Some postman is grooving to all our love letters. Some postman is gonna cry. Some postman is grooving to all our love letters. Some postman is gonna cry. Gonna cry. Gonna cry. It's noon now and all the mailboxes have been emptied and all the letters are inside. He counts them, he checks them, he looks for clues and finds the ones with hearts on the outside. Some postman is grooving to all our love letters. Some postman is gonna cry. Some postman is grooving to all our love letters. Some postman is gonna cry. Gonna cry. Gonna cry. Gonna cry. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Meant for a distant lover, thought it would be there overnight. She waits and she cries and she thinks he does not love her. The postman holds on oh so tight. Yeah! Yeah! Some postman is grooving to all our love letters. Some postman is gonna cry. Some postman is grooving to all our love letters. Some postman is gonna cry. Gonna cry! Yeah! Yo! Crush! Paper hearts! Stole! Stole! Ripped apart! You promised with stamps, but you never delivered to me! No! Some postman you turned out to be.
From some postman to some race, we'll have it pretty soon. In the meantime, we'll take a break here from the Gold Coast. It all looks serene from up there, but things are getting very busy and very noisy in pit lane here as we get set for the Lexmark Indy 300 in 2005. Greg Rust in the pits.
Billy, I'm with the 2001 winner, former series champion. He's qualified on row two today, position four, Cristiano D'Amato. It looks like it's going to be a hot day at the office.
It's going to be a hot day. This race, when it's hot like this, usually is a very tough race. So trying to bet on that, I think there will be a lot of people making mistakes at the end of the race because you get dehydrated and it gets harder and harder to focus. So it's going to be a tough race for everyone. Hard race. If you see, you know, the mix of drivers starting here in the first couple of rows, I think it's going to be a pretty fast-paced race.
We're about to cop a flyby here from the plane. It'll be rather noisy for us in pit lane. Everyone turns their heads skyward. It's been a marvellous sight over the 3 days at the Indy Carnival so far. It lit up the sky the other night with the dump and burn, but for you, Cristiano, there's been some lengthy chats with the PKV racing team over the 2 days of practice and qualifying so far. After this morning, do you think you've got your car where you need it to be today?
Yeah, we've been running good since the first day. We've always been on the top three, top four. Qualifying yesterday, we were third, but obviously because of Sebastian got the pole, so we were kicked back one position. So should be able to fight with these guys today.
Have a great day.
Thank you.
There he is, Cristiano D'Amato, about to get strapped in.
What a warm-up for some of the Team Australia guys. Rob Edwards, the team manager, has gathered them round in a huddle and is giving them their pre-race pep talk. Special guests in that huddle, Queensland State Premier Mr. Peter Beattie, chairman of the Lexmark Indy 300, John Cowley, team owners Derek Walker and Craig Gore. Pretty fascinating just to witness, guys.
Well, it's interesting when you wander up through the pit lane here and have a look at the cars before the race with the covers off. You have a look at the pointy end of the field, that the budgets are a little bit bigger. I said to Ryan Hunter-Reay, what's the deal with these cars here? He said, have a look at these VGs, they call them here, these white fins. A standard Lola wing doesn't have any of that on it. The pointy guys up the front, they get these cars in the wind tunnels. These they call VGs. They go down in under the black fins under the car. They call them vortex generators. He said, you've only got to be about 1 millimetre off with these and the whole car will be upset. Also, Newman has this year introduced the rear wing on the side plate here, the grooves in the side, and a lot of the big budget teams going with that to give them that little bit more speed.
Yeah, it just goes to show there is, even though this is in a sense a parity formula because we have standard Lola chassis, and there was Carl Haas doing his usual blessing of the chassis, standard tyres, standard engines. This is the F111 from one squadron, Amberley Base, squadron leader Gus Cullen, flying officer Scott Hanna on board, having a really enjoyable time, I'd imagine. But, Neil, there is a window of movement here between the teams that they can use to make adjustments.
They can fine-tune the cars. There's a freeze on the aerodynamic development of the cars in terms of the major items, but they are able to do their own little tweaks in some areas. Several of the bigger teams, like this one that's owned by Carl Haas and his partner Paul Newman, do some of their own aerodynamic research. They have wind tunnel programs. They also put the cars on what's called seven-post rigs. They simulate, if you like, racetracks on the tour and around the world, but statically. They bolt the cars to a rig, and they're called shaker rigs, and they run through a whole sequence of numbers. They might spend days, even weeks on those rigs, a very expensive program, and they can look at every track. They'll have looked at Surfers Paradise long before they came here. They'll know exactly what they want from their damper settings. Sebastian Bourdais on the left, his engineer Craig Hampson on the right, they drive for Carl Haas. And this fellow here, young Frenchman, reigning champion, and only a few heartbeats away, most likely from a back-to-back championship title. Bit of aggravation in the recent past with Paul Tracy. Their third coming together at the Las Vegas Speedway only a couple of weeks ago at the previous race, when there was a mix-up. Paul was coming to the pit lane, Sebastian didn't know. The deal was that Paul was apparently supposed to have his left wheels below the white line on the pit lane entry. He hadn't quite got down there when Sebastian tagged him, and Tony Kopman, who's the race director for Champ Car, had a long, hard look at it and decided that neither driver had a case to answer. There's a bit of familiarity in that.
Whether it was Bourdais' fault or not, the big difference between those two in the championship has been, in fact, that Sebastian's had 6 podiums in 11 races, including 5 wins, but all other results have been top 6 finishes and no failures to finish. And of course, Paul, with that Las Vegas crash and a couple of other hiccups that he's had this year, has been heavily penalised. Now, the invocation, the prayer before the event this year, the Reverend Hunter Floyd.
Let's take a moment this afternoon and place ourselves in the Lord's hands. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this glorious day that you've given us here in Queensland. Like all days, it is one of your making, and it's fitting, therefore, that we should pause and give you thanks and praise. Father, we thank you for the friendship between Australia and the United States that allows this American-based series to come with drivers from all over the world to do battle here on the streets of Surfers Paradise. We acknowledge with thanks the talents, enthusiasm, and dedication of all those who have worked so hard to make this event possible. Now, as we approach the start of our Champ Car race and the Supercar race to follow, we ask your protection for our drivers and their crews, our track workers, safety teams, and race officials, those in security, our media and photographers, the public relations folks, our volunteers, the sponsors, and the vendors, and most of all of the fans who have gathered here today. Grant us safe racing and traveling mercies, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you please remain standing for our national anthems sung by Ricky Lee?
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets regular. Was still there. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave? Oh, let us rejoice, for we are young and free. We've golden soil and wealth for toil. Our home is girt by sea. Our land abounds in nature's gifts of beauty, rich and rare. In history's page, let every stage advance Australia fair. In joyful surrender, sing, advance Australia fair.
What a sight here. Squadron Leader Gus Cullen, Flying Officer Scott Hanna. Great timing, fellas. Right at the end of the anthem, they flew over the circuit and everybody gave a rousing cheer. Plenty of excitement still to come. And Neil, I don't know, a few butterflies in the stomach. There always is before a race like this, because you just never know what's going to take place. Paul Tracy there having a word.
He's talking to Brian Maher from Forsyth Championship Racing, and this bloke has had some great performances on this track. He won the race a long time ago now, way back in the mid-90s. Let's go down to Lee.
Someone else pretty pumped up for this race, Neil, is AJ Armendinger from Roosport, ready to go?
Of course. You know, we're in Surfers Paradise, Australia. So, you know, no matter what, we're at least going to have some fun.
You qualified well. You start on the third row. Things looking good for the race. You got a good race car.
Yeah, you know, we've been improving it all weekend. You know, Roosport's and the whole crew and team's done a great job. You know, we got Intel on the side of the car, TDK, Acer, and of course, you got to have some Red Bull before the race. So, you know, we're ready to go, and you know, maybe PT will get crazy in turn one. We'll see.
He learned a lot in his maiden voyage around the streets of Surfers Paradise last year.
AJ Allendinger there, paying a few bills on national television. Best results this year, incidentally, finished second in Milwaukee and Cleveland. He's only 23 and he is one of the bright young talents. So is Michael McDowell, who's making his debut here this weekend, replacing Ryan Hunter-Reay, who basically had a disagreement with his team. It revolved around how much money he's prepared to pay to stay there. Michael's only 20, another promising talent. So plenty on display here as we go to Adam Brand to sing for us Waltzing Matilda.
Once a jolly swagman came by a billabong under the shade of a coolabah tree, and he sang as he watched and waited till his billy boiled. You come a waltzing Matilda with me. Waltzing Matilda, waltzing Matilda. You come a waltzing Matilda with me. And he sang as he watched and waited till he's Billy Boyle. You come along, sing Matilda with me.
Come on, everybody, let's sing it together for Gorey's Green and Gold Team Australia. 2, 3, 4. Waltzing Matilda, you come a waltzing Matilda with me. And he sang as he watched and waited till his Billy boiled. You come a waltzing Matilda with me. And you come a waltzing Matilda with me.
Adam Brand, and we will take a break. When we come back, we'll be racing here at Surfers Paradise. Hang about. Sebastian Bourdais is very close. He can afford to relax. Everything's ship-shaped so far. He only needs to greet the green flag to secure this championship. So today is really all about pure racing, and that's not a bad thing. Brett Crusher-Murray there giving the final all the best to Marcus Marshall. Also racing is Will Power for that team.
Gentlemen, start your engines.
There you go, Adam Brand sets it up. Marshall in car number 5 for Team Australia. Tagliani in 15, Power in 25.
Mario Dominguez, Mexican driver who's got the flu today. This is the 15th running, believe it or not, of the Indy Carnival here on the Gold Coast. Round 12 of 13, the Lexmark Indy 300. Points paid from 1st through to 20th in this championship. They awarded points for pole position on Friday and Saturday, so Bourdais and Servia both enjoyed a point each. Also points up for most laps led, most positions gained, and fastest lap of the motor race. Electric starters, turns over the engine from the rear. Just quick squirt of the throttle and flick the ignition switch to on. And the cars fire up. They will burn about 6 to 6.5 litres of methanol per lap. They have a maximum capacity of 132 litres, so expect to see the first scheduled pit stops around lap 18 or thereabouts, but of course that may change according to the way in which the safety car deals with this motor race if there's an incident that requires full course yellow and some form of intervention.
The map of pit stops from last year's race, for example, was almost all under yellow. There were very, very few pit stops made under green as we travel with the Vortex Flycam. A long pit lane, 350 metres.
Nelson Philippe. Paddy Jack Conquest entry, that's Eric Bachelard's team. They've restarted the car. He must have stalled it as he's grabbed the gear. The blinking red light on the rear tells everybody in the lane that the pit lane speed limiter is engaged. And in Champ Car competition, that means 50 miles per hour, 80 kilometres per hour. And then they exit the lane there across that blend line that takes them back onto the circuit proper. They actually shortcut that initial chicane and join in the middle of it there. Quite legal, even though it looks a little odd because they're not on the racetrack. There are 8 first-time visitors to Surfers Paradise this weekend as we look at Paul Tracy on board Jerry Forsyth's Lola Ford Cosworth. The 8 of them include Ronnie Brame of Fabrizio Del Monte, Timo Glock, ex-Formula One driver, Marcus Marshall, who's been here before in other categories but not in Champ Car, Michael McDowell, the reigning star Mazda champion from the US, Will Power, Andrew Ranger, Ricardo Sperafico, and here is how they line up for this second last round of the championship.
Bourdais there, courtesy of his fastest time on Friday. He wasn't in the top 2 on Saturday, but it didn't matter. He probably would have been, though, but he had a very incidental run on Saturday. Dominguez and Damada on road 2. That's good for Damada. They've been doing a lot of work, and he's pretty confident going into this race. Hasn't been for much of the year, although he has picked up a win. Paul Tracy will be very dangerous from P5. He, too, was quick. We've had a lot of this year in Champ Car racing, and that is guys complaining about traffic and red flag interruptions stopping their momentum in qualifying. So we've had a few situations where there have been some rather quick cars further down the order than you'd expect. Alex Tagliani, the first of the Team Australia cars, didn't qualify all that much faster than the two young Australians, which is encouraging for them. And I mentioned, if you've just joined us, I mentioned not too long ago that all the drivers were saying pretty much the same thing about the cars when they came in after qualifying. So that means that all the engineers could head in the right direction. Let's hope they've made some gains in time. Only the one practice session I mentioned earlier, Justin Wilson topping the times there, although the actual time, not the most important thing this morning as they work out their race strategies and setups. Bramer and McDowell, two of the rookies that Neil mentioned, further down the order, Andrew Ranger, Ricardo Sperafico, who's a cousin of Alex Sperafico, who has also appeared in the Champ Car World Series. Ricardo with very limited experience, and Fabrizio Del Monte on that subject, making only his second appearance in this series. He drove at Long Beach, and if you're going to get some homework done on the Surfers Paradise Circuit, and you only have one other race to practice in, Long Beach is the one to do it. The very first round, very similar sort of race to this. He qualified 16th and finished 19th there, and it's all a big learning experience for him.
19 starters in all, representing 11 nationalities. Canada with three, the US with three, Australia with two this year. We're joining here with AJ Allmendinger in the Roosport Intel entry. This is what turn one, the Lexmark chicane, looks like. Paul Tracy told me this morning that in qualifying with green tyres on, they can actually sneak through there in third gear. They carry amazing speed.
Big team in the pits this weekend, of course, and already very familiar with everybody down there. Daryl Beattie, Lee Diffie, and right now, Gregory Rust.
Billy, to give you an idea of the sort of confidence that Cristiano DeMatta has ahead of this race, he was the first driver strapped into his car. He sat through most of the invocation and both of the anthems in his car, focused and ready. He wants to do the job here. The other team ready for Money Day is the McDonald's crew. They've just given themselves a little handshake, wished themselves the best. This could be the day that Sebastian Bourdais gets his hand on the Vanderbilt Cup for the second year in succession.
British driver Justin Wilson is feeling very confident for this race. The team is satisfied that they've made significant progress each and every session. They've come up through the order. We saw that in this morning's warm-up. Keep your eyes out for Justin Wilson.
Think of these guys that Neil mentioned earlier when they stop around lap 17. A rear wheel and the tyre on one of these champ cars is about 17.5 kilos. Picking it up is a huge effort. It's going to be a struggle for these guys today in quick pit stops in the temperatures. And already this wheel here in the sun, the rim and the tyre getting a lot of temperature into it.
In the practice this morning, you could see the teams drilling. More pit stop practice, more, very quick.
This shot that we're looking at here, the panning camera beneath the car is looking rearward with Paul Tracy's Forsyth Racing Lola. It's a great shot. It gives you an indication of how close to the road these cars are, and when this thing gets up to racing speed, the shot will blow you away for absolute pace.
Only three Aussies have driven champ cars here since the debut of this event in 91. Gary Brabham in 92 and 93, Jason Bright in 2000, David Bernard last year actually came up with the best result of all of them, seventh in a one-off.
They won't have any trouble at all making tyre temperature out there today, but they will be making sure that they've got reasonable brake temperature. And while they do all this, they've got to manage their fuel a little here as well, Billy. They can't just fan up and down on the throttle or they'll jam fuel through the engine. And they want to try and get these things through as far as they can on the first load of fuel to give themselves the maximum window opportunities for pitting later in the race. Four previous winners in this event: Paul Tracy, Jimmy Vassar, Cristiano DeMatta, and Mario Dominguez, and this is the second parade lap coming to a completion. There's Oriol Servia, and race control is complaining about the margins between the cars at the moment. They're significant between each of the vehicles, Lee.
Neil, you mentioned fuel mileage, fuel economy. The top five drivers in last year's race all did a three-stop strategy. The general consensus down here today, that will be the same again.
Five-time winner Sebastian Bourdais looking to build on it. The green flag will fly next lap. Paul Tracy's won a couple of races this year. DeMatta's won a race. Bruno Junqueira before the Indy 500 injury. There's Carl Haas, team owner. Oriol Servia got his breakthrough win in Montreal, so it's been a pole and a win in 2005 for the Catalunyan. Justin Wilson was the winner in Toronto. So if you look at street circuit form, Wilson has been very good. DeMatta has been very good. Bourdais, as always, very good. And Paul Tracy, and we'll expect to see fireworks from each of those guys today. There's DeMatta. This is Paul Tracy, number three on the nose of that car. This is exiting turn four. Just buzzing up the engine. 750 horsepower, this little V8 Ford Cosworth engine. A lot of torque. Very, very easy to make wheels spin on cold tyres with these cars, and they're aggressively cycling temperature into them at the moment.
11 nations represented in this field this weekend.
and starter. We're going to try going this time by.
Look at Paul just dance the car on second gear coming out of that right-hander in the Varta Kart S's. Just sliding down the camber of the road. This is the complex at turn seven for the VB chicane. As we look overhead, the cars are heading north here.
They'll have to squeeze up a bit. They'll have to form up for a start this time round.
Bumpy approach to turn eight. A lot of people over the years have made mistakes here. This is where David Bernard and Stephen Richards got together in the V8 supercar event. There is runoff you can see further up to the right. Pace car lights are out. We are expecting a green flag this time through. There's the big pond, turn nine. Clear at turn 10, and then they come into the final complex, the Lexmark at 11 and 12. Always a passionate audience on the hill here. They've had a thrilling weekend of motor racing. Big day for Will Power, champ car racing debut.
They'll have to catch up at the back.
Their starter at 12. Got at least four. Green flag, green flag.
And we're racing. Green flag in the Lexmark Indy 300. The first chicane is always dicey. We hold our breath as the field files through. Oh, it's already a crash.
Massive crash. D'Amato tagged the back of Serbia. Both those cars have got damage. And D'Amato will be out of the motor race. And Serbia's stalled there. I don't know how much damage to his car. So the pole sitter out of the race in the first 250 metres. And one of the Forsyth cars is damaged as well. Is that Tracy or Dominguez? I think it's Dominguez. Paul Tracy leads. Full course yellow is expected. Sebastian Bourdais is through. There's AJ Allmendinger in third place. And the next man through. Let's have a look at the replay here. We'll see what happens. Watch for Serbia. The second car gets tagged.
Oh,
big contact.
Well, Tracy caught a flyer.
This is D'Amato getting right into the back of Serbia. Turns him round aggressively in the first chicane. And the pits are closed, incidentally, while all this goes on.
Tracy caught a flyer from P4. And that, in effect, helped him get away from that carnage which caught Mario Dominguez.
Yeah, Dominguez has copped front right damage and he'll be out of business. Paul Tracy was situationally aware. He moved to the left and straight lined the chicane. Look at the damage here on the Dominguez car. He came into this race with a bad dose of the flu after the long 14-hour journey across from the US. He's been feeling woeful all weekend, but he was absolutely delighted with his practice and qualifying form. He's going to have less than a smile on his face when he gets back to pit lane here.
He started a couple of positions behind his teammate, but he rushed up past Dominguez, and in doing so, managed to avoid that collision. And there is such disappointment.
Now, Oriel's away again, so doesn't look like there's a lot of obvious damage to this car, but it'll be interesting to see what the back of it looks like when they get it back there. Greg?
There's been a fair bit of chat already, Neil, between Craig Hampson, Tom Smith and Sebastian Bourdais. What they're concerned about, the engineering truss down there on Sebastian Bourdais' car, is whether he may have picked up any of the debris. The replay there seemed to suggest he was further forward of it, but they want to look at his car when it comes by next time.
Two A-arms on standby down here, Neil. The Mario Dominguez pit. His engineer, Mike Pawlowski, has been in contact with the Mexican driver. He is on his way in the best he can. And those A-arms ready to go.
There's the heavily damaged car of Cristiano D'Amato being towed away. Great disappointment for him. 2001 race winner. Very strong in this morning's warm-up. Strong in second qualifying yesterday. It looked like a pretty straightforward mistake on cold tyres, straight into the back of Oriel into that first chicane.
Yesterday was one of his best sessions all year. He'd had five top ten finishes, but other than his win in Portland, nothing in the top five. It's been a very mediocre season, but
Oriel pit.
Pit's open now. Of course, Dominguez gets the chance to repair this car.
Let me know as soon as possible.
So they take the precaution here to put fuel in, see how they top it up. They squirt water because methanol is a water-soluble fuel to disperse that to make sure there's a reduced fire risk. And that's a lot of work on there. They may well change it, but in a business where precision is critical in a single-seat racing car, she's going to be fairly wildly wheel-aligned, Lee.
Neil, they are saying no go. They've given it to the all-over sign. The race is done for Mario Dominguez. They are unbelting him. Day done for the sick Mexican. and he is not happy. Not only through feeling ill in this terribly humid weather, but his day is done, and he's just watched the replay on the big screen down here, said something in his helmet, and he's just standing there. He can't yet pull himself out of the cockpit. Very disappointed, frustrated, angry. The team are consoling him, patting him on the back. He's pushed them away.
Oriol Servia's crew are on standby here. They have four brand new tyres for him, a new front wing assembly, a nose cone as well. We'll get an idea of how bad the damage is to this car. Some suggestion further down the pit lane that Sebastian Bourdais' crew are concerned that Paul Tracy may have shortcutted the chicane in avoiding all this this incident at turn one.
There,
lining up the new front nose cone assembly there now. Fresh rubber on for Servia, and he's back out.
There was some questioning going on behind the scenes in the radios from Sebastian Bourdais and the Newman Haas crew as to the positioning on the track of Paul Tracy as a result of the yellow flags flying, and race control have confirmed that Paul doesn't need to readdress his position in the field at the moment. He's free to stay at the front of the pack and doesn't need to slot in behind Sebastian. So Oriol rejoins in a very fast car, but at the back of this field and down.
An extraordinary start for Tracy, leaping ahead of the field from fifth position at the start. Moved up to fourth almost immediately and then dived through everybody. A couple of them, of course, were taken out. Bourdais, Almendinger, Wilson, Tagliani up to fifth. Vasser, Glock, Willpower in eighth from Rodolfo Levin and Marcus Marshall. That's your top ten. And the three Team Australia cars are in it.
And all that carbon fibre that you saw flying down at turn one needs to be cleaned up. Massive amount of damage down there, and a lot of money spent with all that stuff floating around right at this critical breaking point, Darryl.
Neil, it's interesting when I just wander around the pit barge or the tent here with Team Australia and look at the torque settings on the two different cars between Marcus Marshall and Alex Tagliani. Marshall running on it on three, Tagliani on six at the moment, so running different torque settings.
Yes, they have a it's described as a map, so a splash and dash there for Del Monte just to make sure they've got a better fuel window now. Top it up with fuel, he can run longer. The torque maps on the engine give them a variation in the way the engines deliver their power, but we'll come back to that because Lee's got an important interview here.
Well, it is a very frustrated and angry Mario Dominguez. How did you see that?
There was nowhere to go, really. A car on the right-hand side hit the wall and bounced right in front of me, and it's too bad because my car was good. We had a chance of doing a strong race.
Sorry to see it happen.
Mario gets an early shower today. Meanwhile, we continue under yellow. Paul Tracy in front. Shouldn't be too long before we go green again. They did a pretty good job getting that car out of the way.
It's fairly predictable that we get drama down at the first turn here. It happens almost each year. If not in this category, then one of the others. There's invariably big contact down there every year we visit. It's a very awkward approach. It turns to the right and then clamps up tight for that left-hander. And the reason the chicane is there is just to simply take pace out of the cars, or they'd be doing a gazillion miles an hour down at the next chicane, Greg.
Neil, you mentioned before about the officials not needing Paul Tracy to readdress his current position on the track. I can tell you the McDonald's team, and specifically Craig Hampson, the engineer who works on Sebastian Bourdais' car, they are not happy about this at all. They believe it's wrong. It's not right.
Yes, Sebastian was on the radio just querying Craig and making a complaint about and saying that he shouldn't be there. We saw Paul go to the left to avoid the drama down at the first turn. Clearly, the race director, Tony Kottmann, is an expat Kiwi, lives in the US these days, is happy with things as they are. He takes information from the corner workers to make sure that they're satisfied, and they feel he doesn't have a case to answer. So Tracy will lead the field from Bourdais, so it sets up a very good battle. AJ Allmendinger in third place.
He's really backing him up too, the safety car getting away from them, of course, heading for pit lane as quickly as possible. Tracy just holding him up here and getting the jump as they go green down the straight, around the Honda hairpin.
Green flag.
Off we go again.
This should hopefully be a bit cleaner. I think Paul Tracy had the brakes locked a little on the run into the chicane that time.
They're treading very, very carefully indeed. That's Tagliani up in fifth place in the green and gold. Jimmy Vassa just behind him in car number 12.
Race leader between turns 3 and 4. Comes out in second, briefly in third gear. Second gear for turn 4. Uses all the exit space, tries not to slide onto the back straight too much. He's got to nurse these tyres, keep them in good shape, because we know that Bourdais in this car will be strong on this track.
Allmendinger in third place had exactly that, Neil, as he just struggled to get on the gas out of that corner, and there's a little bit of a gap opened up between the top two.
It's a member of Aurel Servia's crew there carrying some wing components down to their pit area, which is a long way from their garage. That'll be a hot run today. Greg?
Cristiano D'Amato had high hopes on his return to the Champ Car race on the Gold Coast. Just give us your version of events.
Well, I just couldn't slow my car enough. I was probably too close to Servia and end up clipping his, hitting his right rear tire. So, very, very stupid accident. Definitely didn't need that. First time we were performing well in the street courses, we definitely needed the result. So I cannot tell how disappointed I am right now.
I think we can tell how disappointed Cristiano is just by his voice there, guys.
Yeah, and I think that, he didn't say it in as many words, but you clearly get the impression that he knows that he's made a pretty big mistake down there for someone so experienced. The margin is 0.6 of a second between Tracy and Bourdais, and while we were with the interview, Bourdais had a little nibble up at Lexmark in the final turn. Had a look at Paul Tracy, but couldn't get it done there. Allmendinger is in third place, and his teammate Justin Wilson is fourth. Team Australia's Alex Tagliani is fifth. We'll take a break here on the coast, and when we return, we'll see what's happening at the Lexmark Indy 300.
Parts being prepared there, the nose assembly for Aurel Servia. Meanwhile, out on the circuit, we have a new series champion by successfully starting the race. Sebastian Bourdais has the Vanderbilt Trophy coming his way. So this is just pure contest between he and Paul Tracy for the win.
The reason they're assembling that front wing is they've just used their spare after that incident, so they need another spare now in case anything occurs. Incidentally, we made a remark earlier about how close Bourdais was to the back of Tracy in the early part of the restart. I had a glimpse at the data here, and he used the best part of 20 seconds of his push to pass, and the allowable time that he has in this race is a total of 75 seconds, and they can use it for no more than 14 seconds at a time. So in order to get close and try and unsettle Paul early, he ate into that bank quite substantially. Paul, meanwhile, still has 66 seconds, and a whole bunch of them are still pretty much at the top end of the range there.
The only other driver who's used that much has been Marcus Marshall, who's in position 11. He's down to 52 seconds, and Greg Rust has more on that.
Billy, it's worth noting, just while Neil's talking about push to pass, that Cristiano D'Amato had used 9 seconds before that incident at the Lexmark chicane. Incidentally, Aurel Servia has recovered to be in position 13. He still has 67 seconds worth of push to pass left to use. Currently, he's second in the championship on 244 points. The real concern in the pit down here, the Pacific Care pit, is the danger man, Paul Tracy. He's on 216 points in third. Newman Haas want a 1-2 in this championship.
Tough break for rookie, Rocket Sports rookie Michael McDowell. This was all that was left of his entire front wing assembly. The wing literally just dropped off. So he came in, they changed, took this nose cone off, put a whole new front wing assembly on, and he's been sent. Speaking of the push to pass button, Neil, regularly they only get 60 seconds of push to pass. So it could be the difference between victory and not winning, how you use that extra 15 seconds.
And they allocate additional push to pass on the longer circuits where there are longer straights like here and Montreal. By the way, Lee, you look great that race suit. They had the Allen-headed bolts taped up on the front of that nose cone so that they can sit it on there, and they rehearse those nose changes very quick. They were doing some of those this morning. Everybody at this point's driving to a fuel burn number on their dashboard. They know what that target is. That's why you saw some people grab a splash and dash early in the race to just relieve themselves of a little bit of the pressure and not having to mind fuel so much in the early stages.
More on that McDowell incident too, when his nose or wing, front wing dropped off. Fabrizio Del Monte, who was behind him at the time, ran straight over the top of it. So hopefully he's come through it okay, but we may see Del Monte come in if there's been any damage, particularly tyre-wise.
Well, you talk racing for the fuel gauge at the moment, Neil. The Tagliani team just handing a piece of paper around to the crew chief there. They're saying to him they're going to try and go on green now right through to lap 21.
Yeah, so that caution period bought them a little bit of time, and it's taken that first pit stop window out from about lap 17, 18 by a couple of laps, obviously. Here's car number 25, Will Power, the Team Australia entry. And he's doing a great job inside the top 10, position 8 at the moment, last lap of 36.8, and he's coming to terms with these very different cars to those cars that he's driven in the past.
His nearest target is Timo Glock up ahead on the racetrack, a man who briefly ran a few races in Formula 1 for the Jordan team, did a pretty good job, was unable to secure a full-time Formula 1 drive, and has instead moved to Champ Car. Nelson Philippe is the man on screen now chasing Will Power, and Rodolfo Levin a little further back on the circuit.
It's a local race, not just in terms of nationality, but Will is from Toowoomba, so he's got a lot of family and friends here this week. And his partner, Kerry Fenwick, who does public relations work for Mark Webber's, come out from the UK just to see her man do his business this weekend at this racetrack, and he's done great business so far. He's been very competitive. It's a real tough task to come to terms with a vehicle that is so much heavier and so much more powerful than those that he's been working with. So he hasn't bothered to play a lot with the car. He's really tried to work himself in. And Derek Walker told me in Montreal that the thing that impressed him most about Will Power was he didn't want to fiddle with the car. When they tested him at Phoenix, he said, Will was terrific because he said, no, there's time in me. Just let me work it through. And, of course, a lot of the teams and engineers don't like the fact that drivers get in and they immediately want to change everything. And then they go through a whole relearning process, which can often be a very costly and time-consuming, often fruitless process.
Will's 11th on the grid, incidentally, is the best qualifying position for an Australian in this event. So he's done extremely well. And don't forget, he has some very, very good people on a hastily put-together team. We talked about it yesterday, but the decision wasn't made to run a third car until after Las Vegas, when Team Australia had to assess and make sure that they had the parts and the chassis to be able to run three cars here. No damage in Las Vegas, so they were able to put together the third car from bits and pieces around the garage. And the team, that's the people behind the scenes, were also put together in the same way. Hasty phone calls made from contacts. Everybody sort of knew somebody who could fill a position, and they came up with some pretty good names. Lee Dykstra, the chief engineer, vastly experienced in this series. Don Lambert, also a very big name on board. And they've gelled together very well and helped Will in his very brief time. Incidentally, in that team, Formula BMW driver Michael Patrizzi is on the signboard for Will Power. And James Davison, young Australian, also trying to secure a name overseas, and I think will be soon signing, if he hasn't announced it already, with Team Australia in one of those championships for next year. He's also on a pit board, I think, for Alex Tagliani. So a real team effort there, Lee.
Guys, when I spoke with Paul Tracy earlier in the week at that sit-down, relaxed interview, and I painted the scenario and the picture of him chasing Bourdais on the last lap here on a sunny Gold Coast afternoon, and he said, well, paybacks are a bitch. I also painted the scenario of what if you're leading and he's coming second? And he said, well, one thing's for sure, I won't be looking in the mirrors. I'll be focused on where I'm going. He's sure doing that right now.
Oriel Servi is carving his way through this field, up to 11th now. He's past Marcus Marshall, Rodolfo Levin, the next target.
Yeah, he needs a pace car now to compress the field to get him back in the game. He's got a very good car. If it does compress, he'll certainly be able to vault over in several cars. So the leading rookie in the field is Timo Glock, then with Will Power, 7th and 8th. The order, just to refresh for you, is Paul Tracy, Sebastian Bourdais, AJ Allmendinger, Justin Wilson. So both Roosport entries, 3rd and 4th. Then Tagliani for Team Australia, and Jimmy Vassa is in 6th, correct?
The PKV Racing team, Neil, are keeping an eye on their final option in this race. Jimmy Vassa, right now he sits in 6th position, just 1.2 seconds behind Alex Tagliani. 7 of the 11 races this year, Jimmy's finished in the top 10, and coming off a season-high 3rd place in Las Vegas. Everyone in the paddock here wanting to know whether this will be Jimmy's last appearance on the Gold Coast as a driver.
Well, he turns 40 next month. This is his 14th year in the series, which pretty much coincides with the evolution of Champ Car Racing in Australia.
It was a bit clumsy there for Sebastian down at turn 3. He just got out of the groove a little bit and was wide of the clean race line. And see how much margin he's given away to Paul there. at that previous corner, and it's allowed AJ Allmendinger just to get a little closer. There's the two Roosport cars, and here's AJ, position three, coming into turn five. They brake so deeply into there in these cars, and they've got so much deceleration. The brake performance, aided by the drag generated from the wings and the downforce from the wings, is truly extraordinary. Massive or short distances by comparison to the V8s down there.
Allmendinger through the chicane, and just behind him, Justin Wilson, Alex Tagliani next.
Briefly in third gear and on the rev limiter on the run here at turn nine. Back to second gear through this little complex, and then coming into the last corner, second, third, fourth, and then all the way back to second again for the Lexmark hairpin. They plant the cars up on top of the curbs there. A little bit of oversteer on the exit for AJ. Sequential shift in his right hand, just pulls it back a notch, and it self-centers and then keeps on all the way up to seventh gear. Let's ride with him and have a listen to the sweet sound of the Ford Cosworth.
Lapping within 1 second of the race leader, so good solid pace for the young Australian.
What was interesting then when we were on board with AJ is we look at Oriel Servia, who is in 11th still at the moment, was just how long he dragged it on the rev limiter in sixth gear coming up to turn five. He didn't grab seventh for that last little run. Often they find if they grab the extra gear going up there, it can just unsettle the car and the braking approach. So quite a lot of drivers have been choosing to just run it on the hard cut. The Ford Cosworth engineers wouldn't be totally thrilled with the idea of the engine being dragged on the limiter for that long, but it's something they monitor carefully.
Servia was hunting Levin there for another position. There he is.
He's up on a bunch of cars here now, so lots of turbulent air. Most of the corners around here, though, are reasonably low speed, and this is where the car relies more on its mechanical grip, and that is the shock absorbers and the springs and the basic geometry of the car, and less so the wings. The wings come into play, they're in play all the time, but they start to become more effective from basically 80 kilometres and north up to 300 k's. And I mentioned in our piece prior to the start of the race that at peak speed around here in kilograms, which is the easiest way for us to understand the numbers now, it's not much short of 2,000 kilograms at peak speed, so that's an enormous load.
Well, at the head of this pack is Timo Glock, who's in seventh place. Then Will Power, Nelson Philippe, Levin, and Servia. There it is. And Servia in his carving through
he's
the field.
And you see the push to pass. He's activated the button. He wants to get an exit here on Del Monte. That's what the flashing red light was. He's using it all the way down there for a maximum of 14 seconds. He's having to work for it, though. Dirty line. Oh, that is close. That was Levin. I'm sorry, not Del Monte. So Rodolfo wanted to argue, and he only just got that done, you know. That wasn't too far away from a contact situation.
I was just about to say, push to pass, he's been fairly economical. He used up 9 seconds there. He's down to 46. And I think Levin was on the same tack because he used up a 7 seconds of push to pass there as well.
Nelson Philippe passing Will Power there as we go back to Oriel Servia. And Servia now slots up into 10th position, displacing the Mexican.
So Tracy, the race leader, by 1.7 seconds from Bourdais, a gap of 3.3 to Allmendinger, but this is a very juicy little bunch. We'll be back soon. Marcus Marshall forced to pit with a loose front wing assembly. Craig Gore is the man on his radio, and he called him in just a few corners ago.
See, here's a new nose assembly. They put the whole thing on there rather than just replacing the flap or the end plates. So Marcus has obviously touched somebody or maybe a wall. Greg, can you add?
Just waiting for Sebastian Bourdais, guys. He's not going to be too far away. They tell me he is complaining of understeer on the radio at the moment, and they are expecting to make a wing adjustment on the Championship Leaders car. Front wing adjustment coming up.
And they've been debating over the radio whether they do half a turn or one complete turn. But it's only a couple of extra kilos of downforce, but it can make an enormous difference in the balance of the car.
Bourdais had closed to within just over a second of Tracy. It's been about a four-tenths gain. And they've had clear track, of course. Almendinger a quite lonely third, and Justin Nielsen an even lonelier fourth. Alex Tagliani is at the head of a fairly extensive queue behind them. And interestingly enough, Wilson has barely used his push to pass. Timo Glock has not used his at all. Neither have Sperafico or Del Monte or Andrew Ranger or Michael McDowell.
Here onto the back of Marcus after he's taken that stop. Lee?
Well, much of the attention will be on Newman Haas and Sebastian Bourdais winning the title today. A lot's on the line for this man, Paul Genelozzi, and his Rocket Sports team. Timo Glock runs a great seventh place at the moment, and you can wrap up Rookie of the Year title today. How much would that mean for your team?
Well, it means that we set two goals at the beginning of the year. One was to make Timo the Rookie of the Year, and the other was to finish in the top eight. We're just barely outside that second goal. A good finish today really matters.
There's still a young team in the Champ Car World Series and taking one step at a time.
Standing by, Oriol Servia's crew have four tyres set. They will refuel him shortly. I've also just been up to the PKV crew. They tell me they are trying to stretch Jimmy Vassar to lap 19. They want to two-stop this if they can. He has been a little concerned about not being able to make too much in the way of inroads on Alex Tagliani, but they don't care about that. They want him just to keep the pace he's currently got and stretch it to lap 19.
Paul Genelozzi's comments there on Timo Glock's situation. It's interesting, $10,000 per position in the top 10, and from 6th down to 10th, which is Cristiano Demata, 173 plays, 130, but from 6th down to 9th, there's only 11 points difference. Very, very tight battle.
Timo Glock, we made reference to before as we ride here with AJ Allmendinger, had a great performance in Montreal the last time they ran on a street or a road course where he was arguing over the lead thanks to some good fuel strategy. Ultimately had to sidestep for Oriol Servia because he straight-lined the chicane. Here is Servia in for service. New Bridgestone tyres. There's the okay, single point ready. Refueling.
Okay, hold it, hold it, hold it, hold it. Go.
Squirt of water there on the dry brake fuel system.
9.54 seconds, Neil, in terms of the time it took to refuel there and throw the tyres at it. No front wing adjustments for the pole sitter.
Well, guys, you have a look at this front wing here where they've got the sticky tape or the duct tape, yellow duct tape throughout practice. They see where it's rubbed on the bottom. This is the one that come off Marcus Marshall's car. You can see it got all loose in the middle here. And Neil, you're right, he's hit the left-hand side here on some curbing or tyres and it's damaged that rubbed strip there.
About 115 litres of fuel has gone into Oriol's car. They get it in at a rate of about 13 litres per second, 3 to 3.5 US gallons per second. So that car now quite heavy. Paul Tracy said to me this morning that the fuel load doesn't really change the balance of these cars like obviously it does in the V8 because of where it's located in the car. In the case of the Champ car, it's just behind the driver and in front of the engine, the 35 US gallon tank in there. But what it does do is change the rhythm of the car as the fuel load burns down in these cars and the whole package gets lighter. They get it away at a rate of about 5 kilos per lap, so it really, after several laps, changes the way your race car feels.
Racing shadowed by Bourdais.
Clear right.
It's Nelson Philippe.
Sure, the fuel's reset.
In the well box entry. Pit lane speed limit of second gear, 80 kilometres an hour. Paul Tracy, we understand, not far away from his first stop. Order is Tracy, Bourdais, Allmendinger, Wilson, Tagliani. They're all driving to the fuel numbers at the moment. Other than that aggressive exchange between Servia and Levine, where they both got into the push to pass, nobody much has done anything with it in the last five or six laps. But I'll wait and see what happens as they cycle through this first set of stops.
5 second gap between Bourdais and Allmendinger.
Will Power is going to come in this lap and Derek Walker is having trouble having radio conversation with Will Power. And here comes Paul. Here he is. There's the control line. He's got to be at 50 miles per hour. He's got to get it arrested by the time he reaches that broken line.
Concentrate on the marks.
That's Neil Micklewright on the radio.
Good. Reset your fuel meter.
That's a button on the steering wheel. Zeroes the fuel burn.
And notice the drink on the pole. Hand it to Tracy. He takes a sip and then he throws it back.
Indication of how pleased Paul Tracy is with this car before he came in. Neil Micklewright on the radio. PT, do you want any changes? No was the answer.
Just spoke to the team at PKV. Same story for Jimmy Vassar. They're throwing brand new Bridgestone Potenzas at this car now, filling it with fuel. They're going to try and get him out so that he rejoins the track ahead of Alex Tagliani. Sebastian, stand by for a stop, guys. Cheers go up here at PKV. Good stop.
Been trying to get a good eye at some of these cars. Neil coming down pit lane, looking at the gurney strips on the back of it, because you were talking earlier a lot about mechanical grip around here with the slow corners. A lot of them running either no strip on the rear wing or just a small one, the 6mm option.
Yeah, a lot of fine tuning to try and just get the right combo around here. Almost everybody, without exception, says that this is quite an awkward track to set up for. Quite bumpy, lots of slow corners that put a premium on mechanical grip. The cars have no traction control anymore. They used to have it, but since they went to the Ford Cosworth package, they don't have it any longer. Here's Bourdais in.
This will be interesting to see how much track position he gained from being out alone for another lap.
They've settled on one turn of front wing, so he's looking for about an extra 8 kilos of downforce on the front of it.
The big question will be
right on the mark.
How quickly can they get him out again?
They're looking for one turn of front wing was the call from the crew. Brand new Bridgestone Potenza tyres on. We'll get an eye on the fuel here for you. 8.9 seconds gone now. 10.07 seconds worth of fuel.
And where is Tracy? Where is Tracy? Bourdais exits.
Alex Tagliani, car 15.
That's restarted.
We're going to have to start that engine. Daryl, what have you got?
Yeah, disappointing, Neil. You've heard it. You've just heard him come across the radio. Engine shut. Now it's slow for him to get the starter into this car. Disaster for Tagliani. Very, very slow stop.
Yeah, that's not good. Don't need to give away that sort of time. Hard enough to earn a tenth of a second on the racetrack, let alone give away 10 or 15 of them. And a blue flag showing there, so the traffic being made aware of the fact that Tagliani's blending back into the racetrack.
They're all cutting through that chicane when they exit pit lane, just to stay out of the way. There's Tagliani going through. Daryl?
Give you an idea of the difference of the time that Tagliani lost there. Will Power was around 11 seconds. Tagliani nearly 26 seconds, so that's huge time on a racetrack.
Fastest lap of the race so far, Sebastian Bourdais at 33.8. Allmendinger's done a 34.0. Wilson's done a 33.9. Paul Tracy's done a 33.7.
And that was a great stop from Bourdais. 4.5 seconds in front of Allmendinger. Then Wilson and Tracy.
Here's Paul. Speeding the power in, gently coming onto the straight, trying not to slide the car around too much. It's a new spec Bridgestone tyre here this weekend. It's a little quicker than last year's. And that's reflected in the qualifying and racing speeds. And here's an interesting fact. Yep. They actually managed to jump Tracy in that stop.
Yep, he did get out in front. It was a very efficient stop. And as they cycled through on the next time round, the timing monitor sorts itself out.
It's a big gap. It's 2.8 seconds.
So well done to the Newman Haas team.
There's the margin, first to second. You saw Bourdais heading up the back straight. There he is.
Allmendinger next, and then Wilson, Vassar, Timo Glock.
So that'll be a combination of a good in lap, a good out lap, and an efficient stop to rattle all four wheels and tyres on and get the fuel in. It didn't appear to be a huge difference in the amount of fuel that was taken on by both of them.
But when Tracy did pit, Bourdais had clear track and a light car, so he was able to make up a fair bit of time. Fabrizio Del Monte, welcome to Champ Car Racing on the Gold Coast, makes his stop. Tagliani has dropped behind Will Power, as we as Darrell indicated, because of the length of time that Tag's spent in pit lane. And Del Monte there with a bit of smoke coming off the tyres.
Not a good way to bring your brand new set of tyres in as you arrive down at the chicane there with one of them all locked up. So he's just being a bit greedy on a cold tyre. No tyre warmers in Champ Car like Formula One. And no grip available on that part of the road.
For Day's lead over Tracy, 3.6 seconds. We'll take a break. Oh, lock up there from Oriel Servia as he hunts down Nelson Philippe for sixth place in the Lexmark Indy 300. But there is bigger news elsewhere in this circuit. Philippe cuts the corner under pressure. Almost looks like he gets out of shape there. But Paul Tracy is out of the race. Paul Tracy has had to pull out in the background. You might notice Will Power and Alex Tagliani. Lee Dippy has more.
Yeah, it started with reports of smoke coming from Paul Tracy's car, then a black flag. He came into the pits and wasn't too long before Neil McElroy said, "That's it, mate." What did happen, Paul?
I don't really know yet. I guess, you know, by the looks of it, it looks like we weren't able to make the fuel mileage that Bordet's made. You know, the engine must have been going tight and it's breathing a lot of fluid out of it, a lot of oil coming out of the breathers, and then I guess it was spewing a lot of oil out of it, and we got the black flag. So I don't really know what happened, but obviously the motor was on its last leg.
Did it give you any indication while in the cockpit?
Not really, but by the indications of it burning more fuel and not being able to pit on the same lap as Bordet, it's obviously there's something wrong with the engine and it's expired.
Well, we know you signed for next year. Can't wait to have you back in 12 months.
Well, I'm just glad the season's going to be over soon. This is the kind of bad luck we've had all year with the Forsythe team, and you know, we've been strong in every race. We just haven't been lucky.
He has had a crook year. Three crashes, one mechanical failure. Very expensive. Six podiums in the first eight rounds. Tracy was right up there with Bourdais in the battle for the title, but three poor results since among those I mentioned. So
Bourdais still hustling though here. He's still got some pressure from Allmendinger. It's not been handed to him on a platter at this point. The team have told him, do not back out of this. Stay with it, because Allmendinger and Wilson and probably even Jimmy Vassar have actually got good speed here at the moment. One interesting thing, it is blisteringly hot out there. The air over this track at the moment has reached 32 degrees. The track temperature is 49 degrees Celsius. This is the man in second place at the moment, AJ Allmendinger, the American driver, young American,
rookie,
a protege of Paul Tracy, helped him through kart racing. Darrell?
Interesting, Neil. Three former winners here gone out of the race so far. It was DeMata, Tracy, Dominguez, the only one left, and let's hope it doesn't come down on him, as Vassa and also Tagliani's team just told him, "Tags, forget about the fuel. Let's just go hard now."
And when all the flurry was going on with Tracy coming to the pit lane with the problems with that engine or gearbox with that car, which they're investigating, down here at turn three, about three laps ago, Bourdais went as close as you want to go to whacking the wall as well. He got in a little bit hot, the car stepped out in the rear, and he started to then understeer towards the exit wall, but fortunately kept it off there. You'll also notice some graphics roll through the bottom of frame earlier on, which show you how much time they have available to them as they're pushed to pass, so keep an eye out for that. Here's the Lexmark replay, watch this. This is what I just referred to. Gets the back stepping out, locks the rears, and then look at the lock he's got on here. He's on the grey, the car understeers out to the wall, and that's only a couple of heartbeats away from drilling into the wall down there, and that would have been curtains for Bourdais. And that was happening at the precise moment where Tracy had the drama with his car.
Back with Allmendinger, 8.385 seconds, rookie of the year last year, Toyota Atlantic champion in 2003. He's on a steady climb. One of the most promising drivers in the series that is on the way back.
He went really well at round three in the 1 mile oval at Milwaukee, and then solid at Portland, and very good second place at Cleveland. But then he just had a succession of dramas in Toronto, at Edmonton and San Jose, and he really got down in the dumps. In fact, the team were a little bit worried about just the way he was approaching his racing, his outlook. He started to become a crushed man, but then he bounced back and has been very strong in the last third of this championship league.
Well, in the old days of Champ Car World Series, you'd see Roger Penske or Chip Ganassi up on the stand, surrounded by engineers right in the middle of it. Well, this is the heartbeat of Roosport, but take a look at this. A sole figure over here watching the timing screens. This is the president of Roosport, Jeremy Dale, all by himself, watching one little screen and keeping a watchful eye on the track.
On that subject, Justin Wilson in third place, 19.3 seconds off the pace. A gap then of about 12 seconds to Jimmy Vassar, who's 4 seconds ahead of Timo Glock. After the first round of stops, it's broken up the field. Oriel Servia next in sixth place, but he's only a few tenths ahead of Nelson Philippe and Will Power, another 3 seconds further back.
A little bit of concern at the moment here in Oriel Servia's pit as he may have a front tyre issue of some sort, possibly a flat spot in between time with the unfortunate demise of Paul Tracy. They've also been crunching the numbers in the Newman Haas pit. All Oriel needs to do, the way they see it, is finish eighth or better to cement that championship 1-2.
Full course yellow,
current
tires, driver's right, turn three.
There's been an incident here somewhere. Full course yellow call.
Turn three, there's an incident, and here's the reason. Will Power is in the wall, the car backed up, broken rear wing, and that is very disappointing for the young Australian on his Champ Car debut.
I was just about to say he's in eighth place, one spot away from where David Bernard finished last year, and he mentioned earlier this week he is taking a leaf out of Bernard's book, not trying to be too gung-ho and just patiently stay out of trouble and get through the event. And quite extraordinary.
We just don't know at this point whether he tangled with somebody. There's some suggestion he may have tangled with Marcus Marshall or Alex Tagliani. This is Tagliani here with the front right flat.
Tagliani was behind him on the track.
Oh, yes. Whoops. That won't go down well back at head office.
Hey Alex, and when you get here, we'll do fuel, tyres.
Very fuel strange tires, indeed.
The man in the centre there with the white shirt on is Derek Walker, the owner of the team from Walker Racing. Front wing damage on Alex's car. Been a bit of a tough weekend. Everybody lost a lot of track time early on with the ordinary weather. They had to compress a lot of their learning into a minimal amount of time. There's the new front wing assembly for the Lola. That's Rob Edwards, the team manager, standing on the wall.
Just come around, Marcus. Come straight in. Just nice and steady. Nice and steady.
Voice of Rob Edwards you heard in the background. They rattle out those Allen-headed bolts. There's six of them around the front. Whole new assembly that's all set, ready to go with the same front wing adjustments on it. Hopefully no suspension damage.
Well, that's two top 10 spots going begging for Team Australia.
These engines don't like sitting there. Oh, look at this. Del Monte done this under caution. That's an average performance.
Didn't get any help there.
Whoa, and the team will certainly be frowning on that. They don't like seeing that kind of mistake made when there's no pressure. Greg?
This yellow period is all good for Jimmy Vassar, who currently sits fourth on the road. Remember, they waited until lap 20 to bring him in for his first stop for refuelling. They say now that for the second stop, he should be able to go. The yellow working right into their plan as far as a two-stop strategy is concerned. He may be able to stretch it to lap 40 or 41 before pitting again.
Well, this guy replaced, or actually we're not watching Del Monte at the moment, Del Monte replacing Bjorn Verdum because Verdum ran out of money in that team. Well, he's cost that team a little bit of money, Fabrizio Del Monte. Let's see if Power can get back involved. We'll be back. Well, the good news is the safety car has compressed the field, so the hard-earned space that Sebastian Bourdais gained from the last round of stops has been lost to AJ Allmendinger. But the bad news is we're hearing from the pits they may not be able to refit Will Power's tail.
No, the damage is too great to the rear wing attachment area, and it also extends towards the back of the suspension. So I don't think Will's too impressed with the state of play out there at the moment. I'm also hearing that Alex Tagliani's got a problem with the ECU on his car. He's tried to recycle it. He's not getting all of the information back in terms of his fuel mileage and burn and various other bits of electronic info. One of the Cosworth engineers there in the background. So not a good start to his Champ Car career, but I'm sure there are better things to come for Will Power and this team. He's on a 3-year deal with Team Australia.
Will had his hands taped there. He mentioned yesterday he had blisters on his gear shifting hand because he's used to paddle shifting, and he was going to expect a lot more wear on that hand during this event, but unfortunately he's not going to get that now. Be interested to hear from him soon. I'm sure we're chasing that. And Ray Neal is on the way. It's travelling north and it's at Burley.
It's down at Burley Heads at the moment. It's about 20 minutes from here. But as the crow flies, if there's a bit of breeze behind it from the south, it'll rocket up here pretty quickly. And we knew that the showers were forecast for later in the day. So here's Tagliani at the back of the field, who has taken a penalty for entering a closed pit. Meantime, Darrell is with Will.
Well, I've got them both here now. I've got Will Power and Derek Walker. Derek, first of all, Tagliani went to the back of the grid. Obviously, he entered a closed pit, but also he's complaining of ECU problems, I believe.
It does seem to be. The engine just conked out there the last time he made a stop. We don't know what it is. We're going to try and limp it home. Obviously, this little incident didn't help us, but hey, these things happen.
Well, we'll get on to Will. Will, obviously disappointing. You were having a good run there lap time-wise in that race as well.
Yeah, it was. The car was all right. It had a bit of understeer, but we're just consistently going along there, and yeah, felt a nasty bump. That's life. I mean, I was going to let him go down the back straight, but maybe he thought different, so oh well, it's the first race.
You feel like maybe he had a problem, that's why he's running new brake issues, or you think he's just had a go from a long way back and got into the back here?
I don't know, maybe he did have brake problems, who knows. I mean, it's just one of those things. I was going to let him go, but he found his own way through.
All right, well done.
Yeah, thank you.
Yes, very disappointing there. Will was showing really good pace. Now we have this compressed field. A few of these cars are laps down, though, from previous problems. But Sebastian Bourdais,
green flag.
He's going green. And look at Almendinger having a crack. Of course, the car in between is a lap down. Marcus Marshall was pulling alongside Bourdais, thought better of it. But AJ Almendinger in that confrontation is unleashed and gets a chance now. Justin Wilson third, then Jimmy Vassar, Timo Glock, Oriel Servia, Nelson Philippe, Ronnie Bramo. Haven't seen much of him in this race, very quiet. Then Rodolfo Levine and Andrew Ranger, the youngster.
And Michael McDowell got very wide there on the run into turn three. Bourdais is skipping away and he was, oh, and McDowell again gets out into the grey there. He was very lucky not to understeer up into the wall. This is the new Champ Car driver, first race in these cars, and he's just getting caught in the flurry of restart activity, which will be very different to what he's been doing. Grand Am sports car racing in America and last year's star Mazda champion in the US. But this is another level again, and the cars behave very differently once the tyres have cooled out and pressured down. The other thing they'll be noticing when the tyres lose a little bit of pressure is the floor on the car will be bottoming substantially over these bumps. It takes a lap or two for them to return to their normal ride height. Now, while the safety car period was on, we crunched, oh, and Marcus went very close to going straight under the back of the Myjack car then, and he would have potentially damaged the second front wing assembly. Crunch some numbers during the pace car period to have a look at how Bourdais managed to round up Tracy in that earlier stop. His in-lap, that is Tracy's in-lap, was nearly a second slower than Bourdais, and Tracy's out-lap, which also takes into account the stationary period, was about 1.5 seconds slower than Bourdais. So it was a question of all of the three critical elements, getting in, the stationary period, and getting out. So Newman Haas and Bourdais did an outstanding job, and that's been one of their strengths throughout the year.
Lee.
Billy, there's an air of confidence in the Roosport camp with those caution periods. They think they've got the fuel economy to go out to, say, lap 43, maybe even 44, before they have to stop again.
Second and third, Almendinger and Wilson for Roosport. Then Jimmy Vassar, Oriel Servia, Nelson Philippe, Ronnie Bramer, Timo Glock, Rodolfo Levine, Andrew Ranger. New rookies in that mix. McDowell, Neil mentioned earlier.
Bourdais has used a little bit more push to pass. He's now got 45 seconds remaining as we look at Justin Wilson. So 75 seconds was the allocation at the commencement of the race.
This is Jimmy Vassar. He's battling in fourth position at the moment. Bourdais, Allmendinger, Wilson and Vassar.
And behind them, a couple of guys who are a lap down, trying to unlap themselves. They're a long way off that. Here we go. Marshall on the outside here. Ooh. Right rear comes into contact with left front. They're both still out there. Time for a break, but there is chaos afoot here in the middle of the field. We'll come back soon for contact. We saw before the break the contact between Justin Wilson and Australia's Marcus Marshall. Marshall was a lap down at the time. Justin has been forced to pit as a result of that, and he's back out on the circuit and well down the order. That was Rodolfo Levine making a pit. It's Bourdais by nearly 4 seconds from Allmendinger. Allmendinger just can't go with him at the moment, and here is debris on the circuit.
Yeah, Justin Wilson exits the pits after replacing that right rear tyre, picks up a plastic bag onto the front suspension on the left, and it's gradually dispersed off the front suspension, so hopefully that doesn't go into a radiator intake and bump up the water or oil temperature on the car on a day where temperature's critical. It's now 30 degree air and 46 track, so it has eased just a little. See, it's just a little bit of it left there on the front left suspension, but had that not wrapped itself around the front suspension and actually gone down into that radiator intake area, that would have been quite disastrous.
Don't forget the red line and the seconds there is available push to pass in this race, and you might have noticed Levin has used up all but 22 seconds. I suspect most of that has been trying to prevent people passing him rather than the other way around. He's been under attack for much of the race. It's Bourdais from Allmendinger. The gap now 4.3 seconds. Bourdais is just running away from him. Almendinger's best two results this year were second positions at Milwaukee and Cleveland. Greg.
It's been a great recovery by Oriol Servia after that incident at the Lexmark chicane on the opening lap. Tyres on, waiting for the fuel here. 10.79 seconds so far for the back right tyre on the on the right-hand side. They're not happy here. They're not happy here in this pit. Yeah, it looked like they were just held up a little. The right rear gave them some problems. There's a lot of pressure in these stops in both V8 Supercar competition and Champ Car, and the guys do their level best, but if ever you get the opportunity to have a go at doing one, you should do it, because it's unbelievably hard to coordinate like these fellas do it.
19 laps to go in the race, Neil. That's pretty much borderline for Servia. Is he fueled up? Can he do it?
It'd be right on the margin. They'll have to make sure that he short shifts.
Drives very carefully.
And they'll be hoping there could be another pace car to intervene to just give them a breather, Lee.
Neil, take a look at this. That glance between Justin Wilson and Michael McDowell, it didn't look like anything too serious, but it's damaged the rim, and that's what caused the tyre to puncture and forced Justin to come in for that unnecessary stop.
Yeah, the rim doesn't look too flash there. All the usual things that happen on street circuits are happening. People tripping over into the first corner, people running into each other, mistakes being made that are costly because the concrete walls flank this racetrack. It's all going pretty much to the script.
The margin between this man, Allmendinger, and Jimmy Vassar is 16 seconds. Another 6 seconds to Nelson Philippe.
And race control are currently signalling car 31, Michael McDowell. He's been getting wave blue flags everywhere as we look here at Ronnie Bramer in the Dale Coyne entry.
Okay, go.
They threw some water at that to disperse.
I need you to hustle. Use your push to pass if you need to.
And Del Monte. Correction, McDowell has been holding up a lot of people, so the bit of frustration there, and if he doesn't get out of the way, then race control are going to intervene.
Bramer now is coming out just in front of Levine, who's just in front of Andrew Ranger, so this could be messy if they're not careful.
Jimmy Vassar's on target for a podium here, the way things are shaping up at the moment, and that'd be good news for him. He came off the back of a third placing in Vegas at the last outing, and that was the best result for this year. We're expecting to see Bourdais in any tick of the clock for his stop. Previous best before the oval track outing for Jimmy was a fourth placing on the streets of Toronto, so his street racing form is shaping up pretty well.
Well, Bourdais should be able to fuel to the finish when he comes in next time around after 39 laps. His lead is only 6 seconds.
They're going to put even more front wing into Sebastian's car for this stop. Another half turn of front wing for the Frenchman when he comes in. He has got a margin of 5.8 seconds now. 39 laps recorded.
And Nelson Philippe's best results to date. Ninth at Edmonton and Denver at the moment. He's running fourth in this race ahead of Timo Glock, who's having a great day as well.
More messages from Tony Kopman at Race Control that the lead cars are coming up behind car 31, so Michael McDowell has got to make some space.
McDowell at one stage early in his career scored 18 consecutive karting wins. It's a far cry from those days.
Here he is blending back onto the track. Serbia goes through. Lee said before, great recovery. And remember, he went right to the back of the pack after the contact with Cristiano Damata in the first chicane on lap one. But when you've got a quick car, and if you get a couple of safety cars, then that can make the difference.
Here we go, Sebastian Bourdais.
Look for the adjustment to the front wing. Full load of fuel. Another four wheels and tyres.
The PKV guys out there, right on the mark. Solid stop here, guys. Pulling on the lights. Adding a half a turn of front wing.
So there you go, you heard it, guys. A half a turn of front wing for Sebastian Bourdais. Tyres going on, fuel as well. We'll keep an eye on the clock. I can tell you for his teammate, Aurel Serbia, that right rear tyre, the wheel nut got pinched on the thread. It wasn't quite lined up properly. That was the reason for his slow stop. 10.94 for Sebastian Bourdais.
Plenty of applause down here at Roosport as well. AJ Armaniga has been sent. No changes to that car. Fuel and tyres only. His engineer, Chris Lurch, is a first-year engineer. Imagine the pressure as he tries to assist AJ to his first Champ Car victory.
And here's Jimmy Vassar in for his stop. Third in the race at the moment, so the lead pair have been and gone. There goes JB.
Four wheels under the line, Jimmy.
Looks like a good stop.
So, one, two, three, in and out of the pit safely. But the margins between them are quite hefty. There'll be no dicing, and they should all be fueled to the finish.
This is his 230th Champ Car start. Oh, a bit of a flurry down here as they wind their way around through that first chicane. There's no room down there for two cars side by side.
Marshall, the only Team Australia car, still out there. Well, Tagliani, of course, is up there a bit closer to the front, but he's down there at the back and catching a lot of traffic along with McDowell. Greg.
Neil Crompton asked the question before about economy for Aurel Serbia and whether he should be able to get through to the finish. I've just had a word to the Pacific Care team. They tell me we think so. We should be okay for now. Jimmy Vassar, he was right on schedule. They believe they could stretch him to lap 41. He will go right through to the finish. No problems for Jimmy Vassar.
So for those that pitted a lap or two early, they're right on the margin. I just refer back to the remarks that I made right at the very beginning of the race and the way that, in which they get through fuel, which is very much up to the driver and what he does with his right foot, but they're burning in the order of 6 to 6.5 litres per lap. Incidentally, methanol's a little heavier than the fuel we use in V8 supercar. It's about 0.8 of a kilo per litre. So those that pitted one or two laps earlier, when you're getting through that sort of rate, you're going to have to be very careful to get through to the very end.
Serbia could do some damage here. He's lapping 2 seconds quicker than the cars around him in the 134's lead.
Neil and Bill, as you well know, the smallest things can cause the biggest dramas. That little touch between Justin Wilson and Michael McDowell has grave consequences for Wilson. They are praying for some more yellows down here, because if they don't get them, because he stopped out of his pit sequence, Wilson will have to stop again. If he gets the yellows, he may not.
This is Tagliani attacking Almendinger.
Sorted out the issues with Alex's car and sent him back out again, and he's completely out of sequence.
Well, that's for second place, but he is, as you say, Neil, under a different pit stop sequence. So, oh, here we go. Levin in trouble there. Goes straight across the grass. Should keep him out of the way. Serbia driving a great race. He's in eighth place at the moment, but I mentioned lapping well. He's run into a bit of traffic now, though. We'll come back with more shortly. Nelson Philippe circulating just behind Timo Glock. Up ahead, Justin Wilson. Sebastian Bourdais is in command of this race, though, in P1 with a 9-second buffer. Alex Tagliani next, but he's out of pit stop sequence with the rest. We reckon he'll be in at about 8 laps, Neil, I think, and then Almendinger, who's effectively in second place.
A little bit less than that now, and they just asked Alex on the radio whether he wanted tyres, and he said no tyres, so he's just going to grab fuel only to get him home. Now, cars 2 and 9 have got to readdress this situation. Oriel went by illegally, basically, so they've now asked him from race control to get back behind Justin Wilson and do it all again. So they're messaging them at the moment, this needs to happen, Greg.
Oriel is hustling. I've just had a word to the team down here, Neil. What they want to try and do is put this championship 1-2 beyond doubt of this round. He needs to be ninth or better in order to do that. On current standings, he's okay, but obviously they're keeping an eye on that situation, and certainly at the start, they were very concerned.
Jeremy Dale from Roo Sport. Oriel Servia has been told to readdress that situation with Wilson. Fair call.
Yeah, of course. He passed him. He went underneath him, but he didn't finish the pass. He went across the grass. Well, anyone can do that. So he's got to let him back by. They talked about it in the driver's meeting. That's what he needs to do.
What about your other driver, AJ Almendinger? He's looking good.
Yeah, he's looking good. I mean, Sebastian's got a lot of speed today. AJ's doing a fantastic job. The crew's done a great job. He's a solid P2 really right now because Tag's in front of him. He's got a pit, so we're feeling good about where we're at. I'm not sure we feel like we can go and challenge Sebastian.
It's a pretty accurate observation. He doesn't have the pace today for the McDonald's car, but this is a good outing for Almendinger. And he and Chris Lurch have done a pretty good job of making this thing sing this weekend. Meantime, Tagliani's not far away from this stop where he'll do fuel only, no tyres, for car number 15 for Team Australia. 25 career starts. This is the 26th for AJ Almendinger. He's had one pole. He's been on the podium 5 times, Greg.
During the break, Neil, the team down here, McDonald's, did the number crunching just on how much fuel Sebastian Bourdais would have between now and the flag. They are not concerned about economy. The message was, you can go for it, Seb. We are not worried. You can go hard to the finish.
Talking about going hard to the finish here. Tagliani's driving hard at the moment, trying to recover from those electronic glitches that he had, and a couple of awkward moments, including tangling up with Will Power down at turn 3. He's in a different fuel sequence at the moment to everybody else, but he's about to come in. He's very happy with the rubber performance on the car, and so they're not going to change them, and they'll just stick some methanol in this car to get it home.
L2, are you sure on those tyres? It'll be awfully tight.
Listen to the answer. It's Rob Edwards on the radio, seeking to confirm, are you really sure about these? It's Craig Gore from Team Australia. And not an easy thing to do when you're hustling one of these cars to maintain long conversation on the radio. So the answers tend to be very short and sharp.
There's the gap to Almendinger. Ricardo Spirafico is next, but he is also out of sequence. Jimmy Vassa, Justin Wilson, Oriel Servia, Timo Glock, Nelson Philippe, Ronnie Bramer. That's your top 10. Marcus Marshall, 13th.
Last lap time of Tagliani's was the quickest that he's done in this race so far. Bourdais, the man that's got the outstanding speed. I don't think anybody's got a response to him at the moment. He's done a 32.06. This car's so beautifully matched to the road here. It just climbs the curbs well. Watch these cars closely in practice and qualifying, and both their drivers were able to position them just where they wanted to, and just rubs up against the tyres there in the chicane.
Justin Wilson, another driver who's a little uncertain about whether he can run to the finish here. Carl Haas.
L1, Alex. L1.
Just as they give Alex Tagliani map one for his torque curve on the car, they've given Bourdais L10. So everybody's on different strategy, using their engine in a different way, burning fuel in a different way.
This is Philippe, Levin and Ranger. This is a midfield battle, 10th through 12th. Ranger was Rookie of the Year in Toyota Atlantic last year. 18 years old, the Canadian. Youngest driver ever to be on a Champ Car podium. That was Mexico, round 2.
They're going to pit Tagliani on lap 49. He'll have 8 laps to run. They've just advised him to get him to lap 57. He wanted to know how long is the final stint on the radio. Push to pass has been activated there by Nelson Philippe, just trying to fend off Rodolfo Levin as they make their run down towards turn one. Still got 35 seconds of push to pass left.
Rodolfo's got 6.
Yeah,
not much of the tech. Lee Diffie.
Neil, you've been talking about push to pass there. One of the exciting things from 2007 onwards with this revised Cosworth engine package, they're thinking about doubling the push to pass power.
Sorry, Lee, but there was a clash there with Levin and Philippe. They both got the arms in the air. The typical, it was your fault. No, it was yours.
That was on from about 200 metres back out,
just
wasn't it?
Tight.
Just looked clumsy.
Right there, Rodolfo.
Let's have another look there. Levin almost exhausted his push to pass. He's come up on the inside of Philippe. He's a long way through. Philippe locks up first. Darrell.
Guys, Tagliani's timed this perfectly. He's in the pits. They're taking 5 seconds of fuel on board, so this may go good for Team Australia. They've gone lucky. He's away.
And I don't think they did tyres, which was true to plan, so it was just fuel. He removes the tear off away from the front of the visor. A lot of bugs and dirt and debris. And he rejoins.
And typically cuts through the chicane just to stay out of trouble, build up speed. Justin Wilson just coming past now. That is the call. It's Bourdais from Almendinger. This is why.
There's no substantial damage on either of the two cars down here at Turn 3, but they just got awkwardly parked on the outside. Once Levin went to the inside down there, there was no way he was going to stop the car on the dirty offline, and he just clumsily banged wheels with Philippe.
Out of traffic. Yeah.
Now, back to Lee. Sorry about that, mate.
That's all right, Billy, but do you see how they're stuck out on the circuit? And, Neil, I know it's been a frustrating point for you that when they come together and stall the car, they can't go anywhere. They need assistance. That's one of the new revisions in 2007 as well. They're thinking about including a starter motor so they can self-start and get going. And they're also considering making these engines twin turbos.
Yeah, they've not just considered it in terms of self-starting. They've actually ratified it for the 2007 car, which is going to be built by Panos. It will include a self-starter, an onboard starter, which I think is a great thing. They've, over the years, cost themselves too much time retrieving cars and getting everybody going again, and management of the series have recognised that. We obviously have it in V8 Supercar Racing. It makes a big difference to the orderly running of the event, Greg.
Just down with Keith Wiggins from HVM. I guess your take on that incident just there involving Rodolfo.
I had a little bit of a coming together.
The car okay?
Yeah, it's fine. Yeah. I mean, he tried to make a pass, didn't quite come off, so that's about all you can say, really.
Brief comment from you on Fabrizio Del Monte, a debut for him here on the Gold Coast this weekend for Fabrizio.
Well, it's been a tough race, first race for him, and not an easy track to start on. All the other guys are up to speed, so it's a bit throwing him in the deep end, and, you know, steadily improved, went quicker each session, so it's a shame he had that little off, but you know.
Thanks, Keith.
That new car that I spoke about from 2007 is a radical departure from the English-built cars that we've seen dominate the series in the recent past, both Lola and Reynard. This will be an American-built chassis, but a lot of the senior Lola engineers have in fact gone to Panos to design this new car. It's going to be 75 kilograms lighter than the current car, packaged smaller, lower, lighter. It's going to be a faster car, so they're very upbeat about this new car.
And a heck of a lot cheaper too, which is going to be a big thing for this series. We'll take a break and come back with more. Jimmy Vassar won this race in 1996 when it was at the front end of the championship. He went on to win the title that year. He is one of the greats, turns 40 next month. And he is heading for a podium finish here, third behind Almendinger, race leader by 14 seconds, Sebastian Bourdais. Now, a short time ago, Nelson Philippe found the wall. They're going to leave him there because there's only a few laps left to run. There he is. It'll be a local yellow flag. Greg.
Oriol Serbia was one of seven drivers to set a qualifying time faster than last year's pole effort. Right now he sits in sixth, and the radio message to him just a moment ago from the Newman Haas team was, come on, let's put some pressure on Justin Wilson. We believe that Wilson is light on fuel. We can pick up another position here, but the gap between Wilson and Serbia right now is more than 2 seconds.
They're also hustling on the radio with Alex Tagliani as well, saying get after Jimmy Vassa. So interesting battle here for the minor placings. Timo Glock is in the DHL Rocket Sports entry. Just back on the topic of Jimmy Vassa, on target at the moment for third placing, but by no means secure. He's been third here on a couple of occasions previously, the year 2000 and 2003, so the old boy's had a bit of success here. He certainly understands how to get the most out of his car around this track.
4 laps to go. Lock in fourth position.
Timo Glock, German driver, hustling behind Oriol Serbia. This is 6th and 7th at the moment.
Well, I was going to say, it's one thing Serbia trying to hunt down Wilson. Glock is certainly in a better position to attack Serbia. Ronnie Bramer is quite some distance behind them in 8th place, but a good result for the rookie. And Ricardo Sperafico, I mentioned earlier, he was out of sequence. He has made that stop, and he's come back in 9th place. It's still a good result for him.
A few smiles starting to appear down here in the Rocket Sports camp, because if their driver Timo Glock remains where he is for another handful of laps, he has wrapped up the Rookie of the Year title.
Here's Tagliani, 4th place at the moment. Been a pretty solid season for him. He's been on the podium already this year. He's really found a happy home at Team Australia and Walker Racing. Straight away at round two, got onto the podium in third position. Another third on the streets of Toronto. And, there's Rob Edwards in the foreground, Derek Walker in the background from Team Australia. 3-car effort this weekend, that is a huge engineering task. 5th at Montreal several weeks earlier.
Okay, Alex, three more laps, minus five.
So he's lost a little bit of ground to Jimmy Vassa. It was 3.5 seconds when they last called him. So he's got a 5-second buffer either side of him. And there's Justin Wilson in pursuit. And that is Tagliani is chasing Vassa, so it's 5 seconds to him. And he's doing it on a set of tyres that have already done some work. Remember, he elected to leave that set of tyres on the 15 car. So Tagliani's probably starting to get towards the bottom of the tread depth on those Bridgestone tyres.
Interesting little side note here, guys. I know we're getting to the critical phase here. Paul Tracy, despite that simmering feud with Sebastian Bourdais in the build-up to this round, Paul is already back in civilian clothing. He's leaving the circuit, but he stopped by Sebastian's pit to congratulate the guys on the way.
The Roosport team were crossing their fingers for a longer yellow. We did get a yellow, but it wasn't long enough. Justin Wilson will have to pit for a splash and dash.
Well, that lifts Serbia up, doesn't it? And possibly even Glock as well. In fact, almost certainly Timo Glock. Not sure about Ronnie Bramer. He's some distance further back. Tagliani has had 4 top 5 finishes this year, including a couple of podiums, so he could be in for another one.
It's really frustrating for a team and a driver when you get near the end of the race and you've just got to grab that extra little bit of fuel. It just means that your day didn't quite unfold as planned. Sometimes you play the gambling game. Safety cars can work in your favour. Gee, this season's come alive for Serbia. When the opportunity came, when Bruno Junqueira hurt himself at Indianapolis in the IRL race there, this fellow stepped up from Dale Coyne Racing as Justin Wilson comes in for fuel. White flag flies, which tells the entire field we're winding down in this motor race.
Watch Rob.
Just enough to get him home. And Sebastian Bourdais is on target for his 6th win of the year. Winner on the streets at Long Beach at that brand new, very successful event at Edmonton and San Jose, another new event on the tour this year, and then also at Denver. So you can see a pattern there in terms of the way he achieves his success, and then that controversial win in Vegas after he got together with Paul Tracy.
Marcus Marshall circulating there in car number 5, up to 11th place. So
there's the white flag in the background for Bourdais. 1 lap remaining.
What a comprehensive performance this has been. He's rolled off a bit. The lead is 11.3 seconds. He's been under very little pressure in this race. Don't forget, last year, 10 podium finishes out of 14 races, including 7 victories. This year, before this round, 6 podiums in 11 races, including 5 victories. So he's heading for a very similar season. The only driver to finish every race this year, and he has had an extraordinary strike rate.
And this will be back-to-back wins for Newman Haas on the Gold Coast. Bruno Jonquera was the winner here last year, and yet again we have a new winner in this motor race, and still no repeat winners, which is quite extraordinary.
It is amazing, and a couple of those repeat winners are getting very close to the end of their careers in Champ Car racing. Jimmy Vassar and Paul Tracy, although Paul will definitely be around for another year. Well, Day's gone close here. Pole in 2003, provisional pole last year. Hasn't been able to quite nail the victory, even though he was a championship winner last year. What a roll call of champions for Newman Haas. Mario Andretti in 84, Michael Andretti in 91, Mansell in 93, Damada in 2002, and this man last year. The crowd's already starting to cheer him, Sebastian Bourdais, as he gets set for a wonderful finish. He can afford to wave back to them, because this man has had one of the most imposing records in Champ Car racing history. Sebastian Bourdais finishes the championship as a champion should. He's won the championship today by starting, and he has won the race.
Great job today, one car, guys. Hell of a deal.
Race win, wrapping up a championship, and the team starting from pole, and Bourdais does victory donuts down at the Lexmark chicane, Greg.
Epson, his engineer, and some of the team will try and get a word with Craig, but as you can imagine, the celebrations, they're going crazy here. That must feel fantastic, Craig.
Yeah, I mean, all we had to do was start the race to clinch the championship, so we knew that, but we wanted to have a good result, because that's a lot more fun to celebrate that way. You know, I feel really bad about what happened with our teammate Oriel. I think we really wanted him to win today, but if he's not going to be able to win, we'll take it, and I'm very proud of the McDonald's team, the whole Newman Haas team. We've done an awesome job all year, and, I mean, that was dominant, right? We were way quicker, right?
Yeah, just phenomenal. The whole way, the pit stops as well, Craig. Everything went so slick today.
Well, it's a great team, and this is truly a team effort. I mean, from the mechanics, the truck drivers, the engineers, the people who work back at the office, everybody works really hard, and this is what you get out of it. So I'm happy for everybody.
Vanderbilt Cup is coming their way. We're heading up for the podium celebration shortly.
Almendinger is second. Vassar third. Tagliani fourth. Great result for Team Australia. Servia, Glock, Wilson, Bramer, Sperafico and Ranger. That's your top 10. Good result for some of those rookies. Marcus Marshall 11th. It was the first time in Las Vegas that Team Australia had two cars in the top 10. We almost did it again. Equaling his best result of the year, AJ Almendinger. Took only 3 races to find the top 5 in Champ Cars. And he is certainly headed for bigger and better things. Confirmation now of the results and some hard luck stories here today, as usual. I mentioned the top 10, there it is. And although Bramer, Sperafico and Ranger were a long way back, they've learned a lot today in their patience on this very rugged Gold Coast circuit. And don't forget, while there's been a lot of rubber laid down, the V8 supercars will be out very soon to take advantage of that. We still have a race to go. Just a little further outside the top 10, Will Power finished 15th. So
he stalled the thing. He was about to do a victory donut. He grabbed reverse. He got himself out of position. He grabbed reverse. He's just exiting.
I guess the clutches are getting a little tight now.
Well, Bourdais learned a hard lesson there, because he beat Alex Zanardi.
Get it back here. They got like a big trophy and everything to give to you.
He beat Alex.
We've been waiting it for 3 weeks. We can wait a little more, right?
We understand, Seb.
He's actually going to leap out of it.
Well, he beat Alex Zanardi's record winning percentage earlier this year by taking his 12th win in only 39 starts. Now he has 16 from 44, including 18 poles. And the reason I mentioned Zanardi's record that Sebastian beat is that Zanardi was famous for the donuts after the race wins. I think Sebastian will have to maybe go back to Alex. And
this is a great result for Jimmy. Fantastic that he's done such a terrific job again here. And congratulations to him. He's a great racer, this guy. He's got a vast amount of racing experience. He counts as good friends, Alex Zanardi and Juan Pablo Montoya.
It's probably his last result here too, I think, which would add a lot to the emotion.
Well, he hasn't made that announcement yet, so he's reserving on that one. Wants time to think about it later in the year. There's AJ Allmendinger. Hot, hard work out there today in these cars. At least there's a little breeze, but for the V8 supercars still to come, it's going to be roaring hot in those cars. Let's go down to Greg.
Well, he was coming off a season-high third place in Las Vegas. Another podium finish for Jimmy Vassar. What a fantastic day for the entire PKV team. I know Kevin Kalkoven and some of the team executives are here with you. The strategy ran perfectly.
Yeah, it really was pretty straightforward, and with the big wreck in the front and that kind of great job by the PKV crew in the pits on the Gulfstream car. I mean, it was easy flying today, but... I don't know what the pace was at the front. When I finally got through clear, I thought I was running pretty good, but I never saw those guys.
Jimmy, everybody here on the Gold Coast this week, we love having you here. We know what a great racer you are. Everyone's questioned whether you would maybe come back as a driver again next year. Situations like this must make you want to come back.
Well, I never really want to leave. It's a hard thing to think about giving the keys to your car to somebody else to drive. But we're gonna evaluate it over the winter and come up with a decision. There's a lot of great candidates, but I think there's still a little life left in the old dog. But you got to give it up sometime. So we're gonna evaluate.
Congratulations! What a great day at the office for Jimmy Vassar.
Thank you very much.
Jay Allmendinger, you have to be happy. Last year an eighth position, this year second. Good improvement.
Yeah, I mean, Roosport did a great job all weekend. We fought initially. The car wasn't that good, and at the end, the car was awesome. I mean, having Intel on the car, TDK, Acer, I think that's a little bit boost of confidence. But, you always got to get some Red Bull, too.
I got to say, the name's pretty big now amongst this Champ Car Series. Everyone's really looking at you for the future.
Well, we got to stop one team right now. That's Newman Haas. But, weekends were really close, and some we struggle a bit. But, it's our second year. They've been doing it for, 100 years or something like that? Isn't that how old they are? So, it's awesome. This is awesome. Surfers Paradise Australia. Couldn't be better than that.
Well done, AJ.
Thank you.
AJ's still paying the bills out there. There are a couple of drivers who are not in this race because they could not pay their way. AJ's certainly looking after his sponsors. And Sebastian Bourdais, a strange way to finish a championship-winning season, but who cares?
He's kind of thrown a spanner in the works of the timing down here. I think the last thing they expected in the staging of the event was for the leader to be parked up at the Yes's at turn 7, taking a bow, standing on the cockpit of his Lola, and then jumping back in.
What's up? Wants to know what?
This is how he got down to the podium. So they've bump started, I understand, so this is him on his way back.
He has an incredible record. This team now has...
Sebastian, are you on the radio? Acknowledge.
...has won 90 races, 64 of them on road and street courses. Formula 3000 champion in 2002. He also won the Spa 24-hour race. And now twice champion in Champ Cars. And of course, the question will always be answered, just what if he had been able to nail a drive in Formula 1? What could he have done? He's certainly one of those guys, Neil, that gives you the impression he would have made a success of it given the right team. But then there are a lot of guys like that.
Well, they need a Frenchman in Formula 1 at the moment. It's been a long time.
Where's the boss?
Billy Camphausen from Champ Car just in the cockpit there. Been a long time since we've not had a Frenchman in Formula 1 with Olivier Panis jumping out. But right now the focus is on this man's success in Champ Car.
There's the Vanderbilt
Cup. That's what it's been all about for this season.
That's a lot of champagne if you want to fill that up and drink it.
And the new Champ Car president, Steve Johnson, who took over 1 month ago from Dick Eidswick. This car, I'll just give him a tap on the head. It's about as much emotion as Carl shows.
And the future is promising, not only for this young driver, but also for the man holding that trophy, the series itself. It's booming with the cost-cutting plans and big, big plans to spend on the feeder series, the Atlantic series. Then they have really set a good platform for development.
Carl just copped some Powerade then for his trouble.
They were having dinner together last night nearby, and they were certainly far more composed then. Greg.
Sebastian Bourdais is about to get out of the McDonald's Champ car here for the second year in succession. He will be presented with the Vanderbilt Cup. Here is Steve Johnson, the president of Champ Car, to make this presentation. What a wonderful drive today. What a great season by the Newman Haas team. And this man in 2004 and again in 2005 is the series champion. He is delighted. Craig Hampson and all of the engineering team have done a marvellous job. A great succession of poles and wins throughout the year, and that's netted Sebastian this trophy. The Flying Frenchman has done it again in 2005. We'll try and get a word with him in just a few moments. Come down, Sebastian. Sebastian, what a great day. And what a tremendous performance by this team. Things went like clockwork for you today.
Yeah, I was really annoyed by the start, really. It wasn't supposed to be like that. I was expecting Oriol to kick off a lot earlier than that. We had a plan to kick off early, and I don't know why, but I saw the guys behind closing on me, so I just matched my speed with Oriol and got the jump, and I think I used the push to pass. He didn't. It was just a mess, and when we got out of this chicane, PT was in front. I couldn't believe it, and Oriol was nowhere to be seen, so it was just terrible for the team. So in the end of the day, just the result swaps around, and that just well deserved for this Newman Haas organization.
I know everyone watching at home back in Le Mans in France will be enormously proud. 2 years in succession you have won this title. Let's look ahead. What about 06 and beyond?
Well, I think are very, very close to be back in this McDonald's car number one, so we'll see.
What a great year. Sebastian Bourdais, the champion in 2005, 2 years in succession, and well done to the Newman Haas outfit, a 1-2.
Yes, a very healthy situation for Sebastian Bourdais, a very healthy situation for Champ Car Racing, and indeed this event, one of the best in the series. Hard to imagine, because for the first time ever, this is not the conclusion of proceedings here. On the Gold Coast. When we come back, they'll be on the podium. And don't forget, V8 Supercar, Race 3, the Gillette Challenge, a little later on. Another win in the race, another championship win for Sebastian Bourdais. Here's Lee Diffie, who will bring you the podium ceremony.
Folks, the Lexmark Indy 300 is 15 years strong, and for the 15th consecutive year, we have a different winner. Driving the McDonald's Newman Haas Lola, please welcome race winner, Sebastian Bourdais. In second place, and in only his second appearance, for Roosport, AJ Allmendinger. And in third place, certainly a crowd favourite. He's been coming here a long time, driving for PKV, Jimmy Vassar. Girls, if you would, it's time for the champagne. Go for it, guys, go. We call forward our VIPs to present first, second and third trophy. To present the third place trophy, the chairman of the Lexmark Indy 300, Mr. John Cowley. Third place to Jimmy Vassar. Guys, if you could take your place on the podium again. First, second, third. Time for your trophy, Jimmy. Presenting second, the Premier of Queensland, Mr. Peter Beattie. And to present first place to the race winner and the newly crowned champion, the Managing Director of Lexmark, Mr. Graham Kittle. Folks, a round of applause for first, second, third. And time for the national anthem of our race winner.
Congratulations, Sebastian Bourdais, and I've got a little stat here, Neil, that's proof that there's a lot of good management involved, as well as good luck and sheer speed in winning a championship like this. When you look at lap leaders for this championship this year, Paul Tracy's led 493 laps, Sebastian Bourdais only 377, including all those today. But when you talk about laps completed, Bourdais has completed 1,239 to Tracy's 1,049. It's been good management of the championship because he's managed to finish more races and finish the races more highly placed, even though Tracy has shown, you know, a lot of speed and led for a lot of those races.
Yeah, Paul's certainly been able to show flashes of brilliance, and he's been at the top of the leaderboard for a fair chunk of the season, but this guy's put it together when it matters most in a number of key locations. There's been a little bit of bad luck gone Paul Tracy's way this year, and there's been a feud between the two, but there's his team owner Carl Haas, and they'll be well pleased with their performance. 2 years in a row, winners on the Gold Coast for Newman Haas.
And we look forward to more vigorous competition, not only at the end of this season, but next year. We'll be back with V8s